You're about to watch another exciting episode of the Dungeon Run, but did you know that you can actually be part of the adventure? Tune in live on Wednesday nights at 6 p.m. Pacific time, and you can make your voice heard and help determine the fate of our adventurers. Hope to see you there.
Hey!
Hi.
Welcome to the Dungeon Run.
Oh my gosh!
And we're in a studio.
What?
Face to face.
All together, we can hug each other.
I know.
Oh my goodness.
All the love, all the affection. Right?
Uh-huh.
Right, Kari?
Yeah.
She's like, don't touch me.
No, don't touch me.
I'm Jared Kjack. I'm going to be your DM for this evening. We're the Dungeon Run. We're a live tabletop role-playing game show. A lot of you that are out there that are currently watching, you already know us and support us, which we greatly, greatly appreciate. Those of you that are new, good news. This is episode one of season two.
Woo!
So you're caught up. You don't need to know anything at all. That being said, we're so excited to have a couple of new people on our show. This is Kari Cartwright.
Woo!
And Surena Marie.
Yay!
They joined our family, although I'm sure they might be regretting it at times.
Not yet.
Not yet.
We're 3 minutes in.
They're just getting to know us. Now. And some of you might also notice that my partner in crime, my beloved second head to my two-headed monster, Ron, is missing today. And the reason why Ron's not here is because he's not feeling well. But I will say this, Ron and I put a lot of time and a lot of energy and a lot of love into what you're gonna see tonight. So everything that you see tonight, including a special treat, which is coming at the end of all of these introductions and announcements that we're making, he made. So Ron, we love you, we miss you, and we can't wait to have you back next week.
Very yes. soon. The two-headed monster will reform.
Yeah.
Yes.
One of its heads got cut off momentarily.
It's gonna, I don't know about cut off.
Well, it's going to grow, yeah.
He's still here. He can still message me on Discord.
Oh,
wait a minute, what?
No.
Oh, my goodness. But as we mentioned, we are on this beautiful stage here, and we wanted to take the moment to call out the reason that all of this is possible is because we are partnering with Two Kings Entertainment here for this new season. Woo! This is their incredible stage. We are amazed and humbled by this partnership. We're so excited for all the amazing stuff we're going to do together. But they are a fantastic production company here in Los Angeles, and we can't wait for everybody to see what we've been up to. But go to twokingsfilms.com to check out more about them. But you're going to be learning more about them soon.
Also, I want to say to one of these cameras, that
one. It's like we haven't done this in person. This is,
boy, guys. So used to just having this. Like this getting up and being able to move.
Oh, man. Can we just, yeah, let's just breathe for a second. Okay.
Hey,
go ahead.
You, over
go
here.
Ahead,
wait,
Jeff.
No, over here. Sean, stop. We have a Patreon. That is how this show is still alive every month from the generous support of our Patreon. So if you want to become a Patreon, that is patreon.com/thedungeonrun, and you get all kinds of cool perks. You get merch discounts. You get behind-the-scenes character secrets from all of us. Last season, I did journal entries. Katie wrote songs. Jared wrote poems. Morgan did
just talked
full
for a long time.
Videos.
Long time.
We're gonna feature films about
thank you.
His
yeah, 45-minute solo
documentary.
And if you want, if there are secrets that you want to see,
wish it were true.
Let us know. We want to provide that for you. So there's also stat blocks from each adventure. I know that the DMs are going to be doing.
Yeah, because there's two of us. Because there's a two-headed monster. Ron and I are going to have even more. What's that? Ron and I are going to have even more stuff to give the Patreon. So if you're subscribed at that tier on our Patreon, the Dungeon Master level, you will get a lot. In fact, a lot of the stuff that you're going to see tonight, and depending on how long it takes for us to get through it, next episode as well, That's going to be going up there as well. So
this
be a
is very intimidating, by the way,
it's
already.
Secrets.
This is not great.
But wait, there's more. There's also merch discounts because we have merch.
We do have some amazing merch.
We have fun swag. We got coffee mugs. We got t-shirts. We got tote bags. We got playing cards. There's all kinds of stuff. So you get exclusive discounts if you're part of our Patreon family.
Woo!
That's it for me.
So a lot of people have been asking about this. And Ron and I did a whole episode where it was just the two of us talking about how interactivity is going to change.
That cooldown is available on our YouTube right now.
Yes, so and there's session zeros out there with each of these characters too. So if you want to know backstory, watch those. Interactivity. So this show is all about interactivity. I'm already seeing stuff coming in. You can get potatoes, you can get yams. The potatoes are now sprouted potatoes.
What?
The yams, yeah. The yams are now cosmic yams.
Cosmic yams. Yeah. Wow.
What does it all mean?
I know, it gets deep. We have balloons as well, where you might get your name shouted out. You'll definitely get your name shouted out if you buy a potato or a yam. But more importantly, is that those will also trigger force cards.
What?
In fact, I'll explain.
You're scaring the new. You're scaring the new ones, Jared.
Cool.
So force cards are things
no properly
that,
warning you for this.
That Ron and I have created with your help, with your suggestions. Some of these are actual suggestions that I got recently.
Amazing.
So they're not all just straight from me. What those force cards do is they actually affect the game. So you get to help us tell this story. And some of the cooler aspects of our first season was the fact that there were force cards that literally changed the arc of the story and the show and people's characters, where we went, what
locations,
we did, how things changed. The combat could completely change at the drop of a hat based off of a force card that gets enacted. So by purchasing those digital items, not only do you hear your name get shouted out, but it also triggers these cards. So check that out down below in the doobly-doo.
Up to 5 cards of either the Force of Nature or the Force of Cosmos can be unlocked every night.
Yes, there are tiers now. So tier 1 is going to be something that has a smaller effect, but tier 2 and 3 and 4 and 5 have larger and larger effects on the game and on the story.
Right.
That's wild, man.
I think that's
enough on interactivity.
Well, and we're moving on from our gold potato and our all that, but we want to shout out to Guy Vox, who bought the final gold potato on our last campaign.
Yay.
So final, in fact, that Jeff did not even get a chance to read it because it was past that time. But we wanted to say thank you. We love you. We know you've been a watcher of our time stream for a long time, and it did not go unnoticed. And you get the honor of being the final gold potato of campaign 1.
Yeah.
Woo! No one can take that from you.
Well
no
done.
One can take that from you.
Who would, honestly?
I mean, I don't know. The internet's crazy, but they can't.
True.
It's yours, Guy Vox. Yours.
I already see some balloons and a cosmic yam coming in, but I'm going to save that for when we get into the show, but I do see it. Thank you.
I'm sitting there is so much nervous energy right now on this side of the table.
We don't even have wine yet.
No.
Imagine when we start adding some booze.
Ooh.
I'm all clammy.
So if you love storytelling as much as you love rolling dice, welcome home. But before we get started, I have a special treat that was put together by myself, Mr. Ron Ogden, and Chris Perry, who's our sound guy and also handling music for us.
Are you gonna sing for us?
No. You do not want that. Show would come to a screeching halt very quickly. We have a secret room, and this is a secret room that the cast is not going to see, that Ron and I came up with and he did a ton of work on, that we're going to show to you now, and it's gonna start things out with a bang. So Sean, whenever you're ready, let us enter the secret room.
We begin floating through space, within a sea of purple gas and twinkling stars, with touches of pink and white strands that permeate the surroundings. The first thing you notice is there is no smell, no noise, nothingness, just infinite silence. Then comes the deep, primal breathing resonating all around you. The air grows thick and heavy, almost solid as you eat it in. Crack! Boom! An explosion of lightning erupts across the horizon, spiraling out in a tightly formed cone of electrical energy. From the center of this explosion, five comets punch through as if ripping apart reality itself. The first comet swirls, spins, and spirals, with wisps of white cloud-like mist billowing out all around it. The second shoots out like a sharp silver bullet, leaving flares of yellow iridescent smoke trailing behind it. The third is wreathed in charcoal bits and glowing red-hot coals, stretching out like fingers rimmed in crimson fire. The fourth sprays a jet of water droplets that immediately freeze and scatter everywhere like ice crystals floating in slow motion. The fifth is a brilliant, bright, blinding array of dazzling lights that fracture and bend into prismatic laser beams. Your vision blurs, then focuses in. You see inside these comets. Encased in a protective swirling shell lay five comatose figures. Our heroes. A dragonborn, an owlin, a wood elf, an ursaka, and an elephant-like humanoid. Crack! Boom! More lightning crosses your vision as a huge gaseous storm, crawling with electrical bolts, builds, swells, and begins to swallow all five comets. In the distance, stars begin to morph and coalesce into the shape of four monstrous glowing eyes. The eyes focus down on the five figures and narrow, as a long, thin, serpentine body takes form, composed of entirely starlight, opalescent scales, and six pairs of razor-sharp claws. You can't help but watch this celestial behemoth streak across the cosmos as it snatches up the five comets within its claws one by one. The giant serpent whips its barbed tail and flies faster and faster through space, clutching these protective shells close to its body, weaving and twisting as it dodges the eruption of a fiery volcano. Huge asteroids colliding in front of it, exploding into gravel. A hissing cloud of toxic vapors crawls over its scales. Bright blue streaks of freezing ice strike the serpent's neck. Finally, it enters a vast rainbow-colored nebula, crackling with gold and silver lightning. All raw elemental powers in their own right. But now they combine and mix together into one colossal form. A gargantuan female figure made up entirely of storms. She envelopes the starry serpent, clutching the comets and propels them forward even faster until crack, boom! A final burst of light, as if a star exploded into a billion pieces, then dissipating away until all that is left is a perfect glass sphere of cosmos. And a second sphere of raw nature, all backdropped by the vast black nothingness of space. The spheres rotate around one another slowly, and your vision ends.
So, at the top of this moment, we're going to begin with Saint. Saint, you don't remember anything after getting sucked up into your storm. You have no idea how much time has passed. This goes for pretty much everybody. You have no idea how much time has passed. All you know is that you're in a tall, cylindrical room. The walls are made of ice. The floor looks like ice. You're floating probably 20 feet off the ground, spread eagle, looking straight down at the floor.
Whoa.
As your vision coalesces, much like the fizzing of this soda, there's a billowing mist that pours out all around you from behind, across the ceiling, across the sides of the walls, and then whoosh, a gust of wind blows through and the mist dissipates and you come careening down to the ground.
Oh.
And right before you hit this cloud of air and moisture that slows your descent and then gently drops you down face first on the cold ground. And when I say cold, I mean you feel like you just walked into a deep freezer.
This power of my god works in mysterious ways, it seems. All right. So she tries to stand up. Is it icy on the floor, too?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Okay. There's a little mat on the floor.
But you're like, says, welcome.
That's nice. 7 feet tall. In fact, that reminds me.
Hospitality's nice.
Thank you. Go ahead and describe your character visually. Don't worry about personality. Just for everybody at home that may have missed the session zero, tell me what you look like.
Okay, so she notices that there's ice on the ground, and she starts to slowly, very gingerly make her way up because Saint is 7 feet tall. She is a half Loxodon, half wood elf creature. So that means she has mostly elven features, but she has some elephant features as well. So she has these big elephant ears. She has two small tusks coming out of her face. Well, small by Loxodon standards, but not by elven standards, as they have told her many times. They're very annoying and dangerous. <Hey. laughs> And her skin is thick. It's elephantine. It's not wrinkled so much, but it is thick enough that she doesn't actually have to wear armor to be protected. Nice. Her ears are pierced. She has a ring around one of her tusks. She's very bejeweled. And she looks more like a bard than she does a cleric, which is what her class is. She's wearing a sage green, soft, billowy tunic, kind of like the one I'm wearing now, and dark purple pants. She has dark purple hair and two braids that come out in the front. And her eyes are sage green. And she does sort of stoop a little bit lower because she is most often the tallest creature in any room. And she's been trying to fit in with elves for half her life. And she also carries a magnificent warhammer that is made of silver, and that is silver, and has a willow bark handle and a shield with the emblem of her god, the sparrow god.
Cool.
What a description.
Yeah. So, oh, don't worry. You're all going to get a chance to describe your character. And it has to be that good.
I also
was going
to
say.
He's a dude.
Yeah, in session zero, I didn't get a chance to describe her. So no one actually knows what she looks like. Yeah, other than that.
Amazing.
So she thunks her shield into the ground and kind of wobbles her way up. And thunks her warhammer in. It's kind of like two awkward skis is trying to get herself up on the ice. Mm-hmm.
So this is your miniature, and this is the room that you're in.
Oh.
I'm going to place it here because that way people can actually see what's going on. Just imagine, though, that room is actually over here.
Whoa.
Okay.
Sean, you can show as much of that as you can. Can you? Yeah, you can see it.
We'll send some photos of the minis on social media. They are beautiful.
Yeah, that's all Ron.
Painted by Ron Ogden.
Yeah. So just as you are picking yourself up and kind of taking in this room, up above you, again, 20 feet up, again, clouds, but this time the clouds are purple. And there's streaks of yellow light kind of beaming out of the purple, and it's swirling, and then all of a sudden this large silver object appears above you, looking straight down, and you can tell that he's going through exactly what you just went through, that kind of like your vision is coalescing and you're just sort of taking in the your surroundings. It's a dragonborn. It's a silver dragonborn. And just, Val, just as your vision coalesces and you're, again, 20 feet off the ground, floating, looking straight down, you see this massive figure standing at the bottom, looking up at you, wondering what's going on, and you come careening down. And as you
can I talk to her
down,
before I fall?
You can shout something as you fall.
What's happening? Who are you?
I don't know.
He comes careening down and lands right on top of you, knocking you to the ground again. She breaks your fall.
Thank you.
Oh, you're welcome.
You glance around the room. Again, cylindrical room, just like that. Walls of ice, floor of ice. There's a little mat. There's a couple little shelves in there as well with some objects on it, but you haven't had a chance to really take all of this in other than the fact that there's this
I think I'm fixated creature. Who are you?
I'm Saint. Who are you?
You don't remember how you got here. All you remember is that last moment you had from your session zero. Oh,
yeah. Are you here because of my god?
I'm sorry?
The Sparrow God, did he bring you here?
I have no idea what you're saying. Strix! Strix, hello!
Looking around, boom! Fire erupts across the ceiling. It licks across the ceiling. There's bits of brimstone that come raining down, singeing your face, singeing your arm. As the fire, if you've ever seen the movie Backdraft, where it literally like is a blanket of fire going across the ceiling.
Yeah.
It's so hot and so intense, even though it's 20 feet up, it starts to melt the ceiling and you feel the heat where you're standing. And this little owl figure appears above you, floating.
That's definitely from my Sparrow.
Arms / wings out, eyes really wide, like dinner plate size. Again, you don't remember how you got here. You just remember being enveloped in flame. And just as you kind of take in these surroundings and you see the silver dragonborn and you see the Luxodon-like creature, you come careening downwards.
Look out!
At both of them.
I'll catch you! Hold up my shield!
You dodge out of the way. You can give me a dex check. Okay. You literally, I mean, you're just standing there. You literally just put your arms out to try to catch.
My shield.
Oh.
My shield.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, just give me a dex check.
Okay.
Does she have advantage?
And I'm going to use these beautiful new dice.
Yeah.
You do have advantage. Gateway guy.
Thank you, gateway guy.
First roll. No pressure.
Okay, it's a 16 plus 0.
Yeah, that's plenty.
All right.
You land, it still kind of stings because you're landing on like a hard shield, but at least it's sort of like softening the blow and you're not hitting face down on hard ice.
Great, so as I'm falling, before I actually hit the shield, You basically see what looks like a cannonball of an owlin, dressed in blue, a gold bandana kind of flapping in the wind. Their arms are outstretched. You see their bandaged arm. And they look like they're kind of running in the air. So it's not like a true flight. It's like when somebody doesn't know how to swim and they're put in the water, that's sort of what Octavius is doing.
Just like doggy paddling.
They're doggy paddling in the air. As they fall, they go, I'm flying! And then smash into your shoes.
Oh no!
Little one.
Oh, hi.
Where did you come from?
I came from underground and I don't. That was the last thing I remember. Where do you come from? Do you live here in this small tunnel?
I certainly don't.
Hi!
Hi.
Oh.
Hello.
Really big.
Oh.
You're really big.
Yes, I've been told. You're quite small.
I am. Am I? I haven't been outside before.
Oh.
So you're the first I've met, I think. Other than... Oh.
Well, you said something about your god. Are you a... Do you know where we are?
No, I don't.
You seem all right about that.
Muddy water starts to stream out from the ceiling.
Uh-oh, something's coming.
And it streaks down the side almost like veins. And in the middle of this muddy water, a elven figure appears with the muddy water, you know, peeling away from her face and her body. And your vision kind of coalesces and you see these figures down below you and you're just about ready to say something. Go ahead and describe yourself before I have you fall.
Okay. So KoKo is a wood elf ranger and has like copper hair with like shaped sides and like a faux hook. And yeah.
Yeah. That's cool. She approves.
Yeah. And has a like almost like a deep blue green like greener than this blue. That's but like I wasted like Zen pants and then like matching underlay of like what's covering her arms and covers her thumbs. And then she's got her like leather armor that's like across her chest and sort of belted here. She's a cape that sort of is like looks like the forest floor on the outside, but cool. It's like just kind of green on the inside. And she kind of has like a, what was it called? A bolero, kind of like made of fur, that's just on her shoulders and kind of gives her a little, you know. And,
sure.
Yeah, but I think she's got like a bunch of bracelets and like matching like choker and earring, like a cuff. And
everyone's so well accessorized.
Yeah. She likes jewelry.
Sure.
Yeah. Okay. I don't know. Is it weird to say they have Asian features?
No.
Not at all.
Yeah. They have. Yeah. So.
Okay. Maybe we got like a half elephant.
Yeah, you think that's weird?
Owl. Wait till we get to Katie.
Katie, you're gonna take that. Yeah, so that's KoKo.
I love it. Yeah. And KoKo comes careening down towards all of you.
Just pop off of the shield and I'll...
Catch me!
Give me another dex check. Saint. Advantage from Gateway Guy.
Thank you, Gateway Guy. Gateway Guy. First two advantages of this season.
Wow.
10.
Not enough.
I'll catch you.
Oh, no.
You can try. Do you want to try?
Yes, I do.
Yes!
I'll roll with advantage
yes,
well.
Octavius. USN Ret.
Little guy, you're not going to...
USN Ret.
That is at 19.
Ooh!
That'll do it.
That's right. With dex.
Wait, hold on. With dex.
Just
actually,
straight dex, right, I think?
That was just straight dex. Oh, so it's a... A 22.
I mean, yours is more of a strength check than a dex check.
Oh. Yeah.
You definitely get there. It's just the weight.
You catch her.
Of like a fully grown elven
figure. Yes, because KoKo's has an athletic build.
Yeah.
So you gotta pay it forward.
So there's this beautiful moment where Octavius is like holding her up, almost like that scene from Dirty Dancing where...
And then,
where you're like a swan, and then your knees give out, and that's what I'm gonna do, and you collapse. You don't take any damage, but it ends poorly at the very end.
Hi, do Frederick the Sky.
Oh, hi. Oh, the bear got knocked out of.
Sorry. My head is pretty hard.
I'm so sorry.
Don't apologize. Okay? Are you okay?
Yeah, I'm okay, but you're okay?
Oh, yeah.
What's happening?
So fine.
I have no idea.
Who are you?
Oh. Hi!
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 Hello.
This is strange.
Not normal for the surface.
Wait a minute.
No, decided
you just
not.
Came out of a bunch of water. You
I
came out
did.
Of fire.
Fire!
But you're not burned, right?
No.
Actually, you look down at Otto's arm, and there's a pretty big burn.
Oh, man. All right.
And I take some cloth from my coat, and I'm like bandaging it up. Yeah, it's fine. It's fine.
You can't tell if the burn is like... Because you literally just see it for a second. You can't tell if it's an older wound or fresh. But there is enough fire that wreathed her that little bits of feather have been scorched and burnt. And
but you should be charred. Much worse than you actually are.
I've been told that I am quite durable.
Oh, well, right.
Can I help you?
Where?
Heal you?
Blinding light.
Oh!
Disco ball light. Coming from up above.
I mean, that's pretty great.
Katie the Michaels demanded this entrance.
Yeah. Non-negotiable. Yeah.
The light bounces off of the ice and reflects, and rainbows illuminate the entire room. It's fractured light. And it's so bright that you actually don't see the figure until it's on top of you. go ahead and describe yourself. As you land on the four of them.
Well, Ursula is 6'2", so not
oh,
small.
No.
She's a Ursaca, Alpine Ursaca, so
which is a homebrew, black bear. Homebrew race.
Yeah, homebrew yeah. race, basically a black bear. And she's 6'2", and very scraggly. Like, she's never seen a mirror in her life, nor should she. I mean, it's gonna be a rude awakening. Her hair's never seen a hairbrush.
Prepare her for it.
A little bit matted, a little wild. She, which you can't quite tell yet because she's on top of all of these people, but also, hilariously, has a bit of a lean down because she's been raised by dwarves her whole life. So, in an attempt to kind of.
There's so much scoliosis in this.
I know. We need a good chiropractor.
Ouch.
This episode brought to you.
In order to fit in, she has kind of bent down. Her clothes also show that she has been in the dwarvish community because her pants are a little too short. She's got like a really beautiful, sparkly, what's the word?
Vestment,
thank you.
Yeah.
That is like the nicest thing on her, and kind of honestly out of place a little bit from the rest of her clothing. But everything is just like a little too short, a little like she's like her mom shrunk her clothes in the dryer or something yeah. like that. Yeah, she has two different colored eyes.
Ooh, what yeah. colors?
One blue and one kind of gold.
Ooh, do they yeah. do anything special?
We'll see. Disco ball
It's a very
nice one. They throw back and forth.
Yeah. They create a party.
A disco ball is her eyes.
Yeah,
actually.
A junior high dance party.
Good. The best kind.
Nice. So all of the miniatures are here. I don't know, Sean, if you can get a shot of that. I just want to appreciate Ron's hard work. They're blurry.
We'll do zoom. Yeah. We'll do close-up shots.
Yeah. But that's... That's the heroes right there. You are in this room, this tall, cylindrical ice room.
Did I take everyone out?
Yes. So now that's you're all sense. Laying prone on the floor.
Maybe we should back up against the wall in case there's any others.
Okay.
Hello.
Others?
Well, so far it hasn't stopped.
We've all fallen from the sky.
All within the last couple minutes. Were you here very long before I showed up?
No, just a few moments.
Okay, yeah, it's all happened so... I'm like cringing, waiting for something else
Where
to happen.
Are we?
This is probably a blessing from a god.
It doesn't really feel like it, though.
It's very cold!
So cold!
It's so cold!
It's deep freezer cold. Arctic temperature cold.
Well, huddle up then. Come here. And she reaches her arms out to bring KoKo and Otto into a hug.
In fact, roll perception.
Okay. Do I have advantage?
Yes, you do. It's counter. Advantage, USN, ret, disadvantage, grim fated. So counter by grim.
Ooh, first disadvantage.
There we go. Countered, so that is a 10 on the die for a 9. Negative 1.
You all notice, even though he doesn't see this, that his scales are actually starting to tighten up. You can see in his movements, and even though you've only been around him for a brief moment, you can see in his movements that his scales seem to be acting almost like armor to the temperature itself. Huh. You are unaffected by the cold.
Yeah.
The rest of you, freezing.
Deeply cold.
Yeah.
I stand up and I try to find the door. I'm just like, all right, let's get out of here.
You turn around and there is an opening that leads to some steps that go down and you walk over. And as you look down those steps, it's dark. And in fact, the room that you are in is barely lit by a tiny little skylight that's letting in a little bit of sunlight, which, because you're in this icy room, sort of bounces around and gives it a soft glow.
Wait, so none of you know where we are?
No.
I don't...
What's the last thing everybody remembers? Maybe we could backtrack our what's similar.
Wait, does everybody know each other?
That was what I was gonna ask.
No, I know.
So you don't...
No, I don't know anyone.
Oh, I thought you were all friends.
I thought you were all friends.
It's so nice of you to say. No.
Well, my name's KoKo.
Hi, KoKo.
Hi.
Hi, I'm Octavius Boxcutter, the first to flee the nest. You can just call me Otto. And I'm he, they.
I'm Saint.
And you're a healer?
Yes, I can heal. I can heal your arm, if you'd like.
Good to know.
Okay.
Yes?
Sure.
Okay. And she casts Healing Word on Otto.
Okay. You are probably only missing like one or two hit points.
Because,
you were
gonna say
because of the
amount. Oh, my feathers. That's all.
The amount of and fire that you endured.
Yeah.
Before you got whisked away. Mm-hmm. But it does heal, and your wound does not heal. Mm-hmm. The other bits and pieces of you that got singed and burned does.
Thank you so much.
You're so welcome. What's
your name?
I'm Ursula Scratch. You can call me Ursula or Scratch.
Do you want to come into the hug?
Sure.
You look cold.
I'm pretty warm. I have a lot of fur.
Oh.
So if I can help hug?
Yeah.
If that's helpful.
Does anyone have materials to make a fire?
Ursula approaches the hug like she's never hugged anyone before. She doesn't quite know what to do with her arms.
Put your arm around here.
Okay, she does like a hover hand behind.
That's nice.
Is this warm?
It's warmer, yes.
Okay.
Val is standing across the room from this weird group hug, just sort of like, uh-huh.
Otto's very small and is so happy and warm.
Like, just in between everyone.
Yeah, just like a little sandwich.
And KoKo's mostly okay with this, kind of excited, but also like, this is so weird.
So just because I want to get to it, we have yams.
Hey!
We have potatoes.
Yay!
And we have balloons. So we'll do the yams first, cosmic yams. There's a yam from JT Justice.
Woo-hoo!
Thank you so much. And another one from Braba.
Thank you, Braba.
That does unlock our first
Force
of Cosmos card. And by the way, these cards, the way we're doing them now, they can be helpful, they can be a hindrance, or they can be completely neutral. The first card is entitled, Let's Do the Time Warp.
Again, we just did.
When the next fight begins, all players may swap initiative rolls with one another before combat officially starts. Mm. The monsters still go during whichever initiative they rolled. And if anyone starts to sing the actual song, which you were close, they add +2 to their score. So I'm going to give that card to you.
Yes. You get to add whatever you... Okay, add +2 to your...
So when we get into the first combat...
Wait, there'll be combat?
Oh, yeah. you guys can move your initiative scores around however you see fit.
Incredible.
So if you get a 19 and you get a 2 and you want Ursula to go first, you can swap.
Okay.
And that's after the combat officially begins and we know what's happening.
Yes. Okay. Everyone will roll initiative and then we'll...
Then we can swap.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Sprouted potatoes for Team Force of Nature. We have City Racing Girl.
Ooh.
Thank you.
Kai Buck. Thank you, Kai Buck. Baby Librarian. And Abracadabra.
That might be the best.
Which that unlocks our Force of Nature tier 1. This was actually suggested by one of the watchers, and it was so close to something that I already had written, but it's better than what I had written, so we're using it. AG McLeod. This is called Queen Mab's Pixie. The thermal gift. A cute pixie named Cheppy pops out of nowhere and says, "Feeling cold? Screw this hard, and now you can be bold."
Wow.
And she hands over a little packet. All of you can roll perception, and whoever gets the highest perception roll wins.
Okay.
We have advantages. So KoKo, Sijo 225, you have advantage.
Nice.
Thank you.
Saint, you have advantage from JT Justice.
Thank you.
Valcorio, you have advantage from Banana Fana Foe Fezeron. Countered by Grim Faded.
Yep.
Octavius, advantage by Banana Fana Faux Fezzeron. And Ursula, advantage by Hadrian X.
We did, by the way, we did roll over some of the advantages from the previous adventure, so and disperse them to the new players and through others. So yes, so there were a lot of advantages and disadvantages left over from campaign one, but we'll be getting to the new ones as well.
Yeah, so who got the highest?
I got 24.
I got 24.
Seven.
Oh, here you go.
19.
22.
I'm the only one who rolled below a 20.
Just d20. Flat d20.
I got 19.
Oh, is that plus your...
I didn't put my plus. Just a straight roll.
Yeah, just a straight roll. Oh, you guys 19. Both got 19?
Yeah. Wow.
What?
All right. All right. So I'll let you two... I'll let you decide between the two of you who gets it. But they... Gosh. This little pixie hands over... Actually, I'm going to give it to you.
Yeah.
This little pixie hands over this... tiny little packet.
Okay.
And tells you, if you squeeze it, it'll warm you up.
I accidentally squeeze it just holding it.
And as soon as you take it, the pixie disappears and the packet immediately starts to warm in your hand.
Oh.
To the point to where if you tuck it into your clothes, it'll act like winter clothing. Whoa. The same effect as winter clothing, which because you guys are in the frozen Arctic, is gonna come in very handy.
Right.
Yeah.
Who's really cold?
I'm fine.
I'm okay.
Mostly.
I have a shirt.
Yeah. Here, you might want this.
Yeah.
Well, thank you.
If you tuck it in your... I mean, it's pretty warm.
Oh, ouch.
I thought that was going to be another person who fell from the sky and was going to sleep with us.
Oh, gosh.
It's been a couple minutes, but I don't... I think we're done? I'm not sure.
Are we going to get out of here or what?
Were you looking at that door?
Well, yes, there's stairs. The stairs go down, yes?
Yes, it is dark.
Oh, we can all see in the dark, right?
Yeah, but no, hang on. So, none of us know where we are.
As you look around, there's also these little shelves in this room, and some of the shelves have stuff on them, and some of them are bare.
Can I look at this stuff?
Yes. Give me a perception check. Octavius, advantage from Labradork.
Labradork!
Oh, thank you for giving me advantage because I got a natty one. So, and he's a perception?
Yep.
Oh, still not great, but it is a 9.
Okay. You're still going to notice the obvious stuff,
okay.
Just not the finer details. On two of these little shelves are idols. And by idols, I mean like there's a 1 foot tall stone statue idol of... you're assuming a goddess. She's veiled and she's wearing this cloak. It's made out of marble. It's relatively nice quality. Female figure, and her face has is it smoothed over, but it looks like it had a veil on it at one point that kind of has been worn down.
Okay.
Yeah, and on the little platform right next to that is a wooden ball about 1 foot in diameter. Mm-hmm. And that wooden ball has hundreds of little carvings. And as you look at the carvings, you can immediately make out an owl carving, and a bear carving, and a wolf, and a chipmunk. And that's when you realize that it's a wood ball that's covered in little animal carvings.
Hey, does this mean anything to anyone? That's me. I think that's you. That might be you.
Which one?
This one that's sort of an elephant-ish.
Oh my goodness.
Oh, you are.
Are any of you from Lunarum?
Have I even heard of Lunarum?
Roll history.
Okay.
This is going to get interesting because you guys are from two different islands.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Saint, advantage from Hadrian X.
Thank you, Hadrian. Oh, I rolled a 5 and a 1.
Never heard of it.
I just have a history bonus.
Yeah. Never heard of it. Must be one of those towns on the South Island.
Alright. Because I don't see a walking, talking owl or a walking, talking bear every day.
No.
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 Or elephant?
Probably not.
But you're a dragon. Why not?
I mean, I don't know. Do you see dragons where you're from?
Is there a dragon on that ball?
You do not see a dragon on the ball.
No, I guess there isn't.
I mean, there's something that could be a dragon because there's obviously like lizards and what have you, but you don't see anything that's obviously a dragon.
No.
Am I on there?
I think it's just animals.
Huh. Was anyone else with someone when whatever happened to you happened?
I was chasing someone.
Yes, I was.
Who?
Right when you think about that, mm-hmm. your hip starts to hurt.
Oh! Ow!
You're right.
Oh my gosh! Ooh, it's a sharp pain in my hip.
Okay?
I don't know what's happening.
It's probably the fall.
Oh, I mean, maybe. Oh, ooh, that was weird. It kind of just went away.
Oh.
I was with someone who is not here now.
Who?
And then she was swept up in the vortex or whatever it is. It was like a cyclone suddenly appeared on the front lawn of my family's house. And then I was gone. But she, I thought, was. And the fact that she's not here is very concerning to me.
My person that I was talking to before I ended up here with you guys, it also is not here.
And she was as surprised about it as I was. So it was not as if it was she cast a spell on me, at least I don't think so. I mean, she might have, to be honest. But I don't think so. Because she cried, help me. And I reached out, and then...
So sad.
I mean, hopefully she's all right.
Were you with anyone, Otto?
I don't want to talk about it. I was. They're not here, but I don't think that they were to get sucked up in the storm anyway. I think they probably died before the storm hit.
So sorry.
It's okay.
All right.
It's not okay, but it's, we are here now, right?
Right.
And this is not a dream. This is real, right?
It might be my dream.
It might be a dream.
Then we just have to wake ourselves up, right?
Right.
Okay. Great.
Ooh. Yeah. That's Otto starts doing the same thing, like patting themselves.
Wake up!
No.
Somebody scare me.
Okay.
No, still here.
What about you, bear girl? You haven't said anything.
Ursula.
Oh,
wait.
Sorry.
You said your name?
Whatever. Yeah. What was your name?
You said you didn't know each other.
Liar. Yeah, I was with. They wouldn't have cast a spell on me. That's not. I was with two people. They're not here, obviously, because none of you were there.
Can I ask? Were the people you were with, were they doing something to you? Like, were you fighting with it? Like, what were you doing?
Do I remember that I was chasing, like, do we remember the specifics?
You remember everything up until the moment where you were sucked up into whatever various storm you got sucked up into.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
I was chasing what I thought was maybe my sister, but it's not likely that it was her.
Oh.
It sure seemed like her, but you're not. You weren't 100% positive when you did get nabbed.
It looked like her, and I was running as fast as I could when I was swept up.
I mean, don't take this the wrong way, but I haven't seen many people who look like you in my life, so it probably was her.
Yes, well, she's also my twin. In case you do see another mirror.
Oh, wow. You're the twin?
There's two 7-foot-tall, half-elephant, half-elven women walking around?
Yes, we both have purple skin as well.
Did you guys
Incredible.
Share an egg?
We did.
That's
yes.
amazing.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Wow. Incredible.
Saint doesn't know how
make a history check. Make a nature check.
She is not smart.
Anyone skilled in medicine?
Ursula, like, not quite knowing how to handle group conversation, is gonna also go look at the shelves and see if there's anything else that she can see.
Yeah, give me another perception check.
Sure.
Ursula, advantage by Hadrian X.
Thank goodness, because that was a natural one. Okay, 17.
So what you notice, other than the two obvious things with the two idols, is that there's one other little shelf that has looks like some melted wax like there was something there at one point. And then when you get really close, like to the point to where you can smell, you smell
a great sense of smell because I'm here.
Right. So. Like like sandalwood or incense of some kind. And because you get so close and because you rolled so well, you also notice there's little bits of something, maybe the glass, you're not quite sure, but it's there's like glimmering little reflective bits.
Like something was like taken, broken and taken from that spot?
Sure, that's definitely a possibility.
Okay.
But you two can roll knowledge religion off of what Otto is holding.
Okay.
Because of who your characters are. Ursula, advantage from Dusky.
Thanks, Dusky.
And Saint, advantage from Hadrian X, but countered by this just 10.
This just 10.
Justin! Come on, man. All right.
I got another nat one in, but then luckily saved it.
I know. All right.
I have a 16.
Okay.
What did you, roll religion or something else?
It's religion.
Yeah. It is religion, okay.
Are we allowed to roll something else?
Okay. I'm a cleric, can I have a plus one?
Okay.
I have to put a request. Can I do my better
self? You both recognize Thassia, the woman, the goddess of storms.
Okay.
Did you say Thassia?
Thassia, Thassia. Okay.
Thassia, the goddess of storms.
Some people say Thassia, but Thassia is the most common pronunciation.
What do we know about the goddess of storms?
Well, you would know quite a bit, just because it kind of folds into your faith as well. The goddess of storms is quite literally the goddess of the island that you four are from, and you would know. Well, you're kind of learned it, not really. You would know,
I've been to school, I didn't pay very good attention.
You would at least know of the goddess of storms.
Right.
She's not heavily worshipped where you're from.
Right.
Magic is key where you're from, so it's other gods that are take the forefront. But she is the goddess that protects this island. This is her home. This is her birthplace. And a lot of people attribute to all of the storms that happen in this area, especially the storms out at sea that keep it almost impossible for ships to come in and leave, to Thassia. She's not just the goddess of storms, she represents a lot. She represents primal energy. She represents all forms of storm, blizzards, tornadoes, you name it. She's also the goddess of protection. And that's why most of the developed areas in the North Island, which there aren't very many populated developed areas, worship her because they don't want to get ripped apart by a storm. So think the gods in this world are very akin to Greek and Norse gods, where they get involved, they do things. They might even show up on a battlefield, or at least their avatar might show up on a battlefield. So that's why even you two would know who Thassia is.
So we know that idol, we know what it is.
You would, if you stare up for any amount of time, you'd figure it out.
Okay.
Yeah. When you first glanced at it, it was just a woman with a cowl, but after a while, you would figure it out.
So when you had them roll religion check?
Yeah, that's a lore check, so they know what they know about
I see.
The given information.
Not if they know any of them. Okay.
Yeah, and if they wanted to know more detailed information, it takes a higher difficulty.
Okay,
That's
speaking for the newbies.
Good job.
Thanks.
Speaking of Katie or Ursula, you recognize the wooden ball as being an idol to Bahatha. Bahatha is the god of animals and of the animus. The animus is the energy that turns natural animals into people. Oh. So Bahatha is the reason why we have Ursaka.
Yeah.
The reason why we have Luxodon. The reason why we have Owlin. In this world, it's all because of Bahatha. And Bahatha tends to be a little bit more neutral and a little bit more removed. Mm-hmm. And at one point, Bahatha was not a major deity, but they grew into power because of the gift of animus and literally creating followers by turning animals into people.
So are they a new god then, relatively? Since this only happened a few hundred years ago?
Bahatha is.
Yeah.
Thassia is not.
Okay.
Thassia has been around for as long as anyone can remember.
Would I have heard of Bahatha at all?
Do you have religion as a skill?
Nope.
Do you have arcana?
Nope. History, but no.
You can roll history.
Sure.
I'm going to make it a higher DC.
He's not James, guys. He's not a librarian this time.
Last cleric of Krypton, thank but you. Countered by Fail Waffle.
Thank you, Fail Waffle, and
I
last
saw
cleric.
That name on another
thing. Pretty good. Pretty good history. That's a 19.
Oh.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. I am smart.
Just not James.
At least this once. Yeah, at least this once.
Thank you. We're going to get along great.
You definitely heard of Bahatha, but as far as like the religious doctrine behind Bahatha, no. But you would know of Bahatha because you've heard of the animus.
Yeah, okay.
Animals turning into people right. is yeah. huge.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah. You don't miss that.
And he doesn't count as an animal who's turned into
a... No, he's a dragonborn. Very different.
While.
So, but you were saying earlier that he hadn't heard... I mean, he's not used to being around...
Dragons aren't animals.
He's not used to being around animal.
He's from the South Island, and the South Island, which you know very little about, the South Island is a very different place.
Okay.
It's populated by different people. They have different beliefs. It's a completely different culture. North Islanders and South Islanders usually don't mix too much because traveling from North Island to South Island is incredibly dangerous because of the storms.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Cool. Thanks.
Would I know of any places in either island that is this like Arctic and cold?
You? No.
No. Okay. Yeah, ringing no bells.
Ringing
no bells over here.
Somebody
knows. Well, some of you are from a more northern part of the North Island.
Uh-huh.
And some of you are from a southern part of the North Island. And some of you are from a northern part of the South Island.
Good.
And if that confuses you, we're going to have a map in the next episode where we show you all of this.
Great. You look like you recognize the bull.
This is you don't?
Vaguely. What is it?
The god of animals.
Bahatha.
She checks her notes.
right, that makes sense why there's so many creatures on there. What's the spherical nature of this? This must be a good place. If there's an idol to Thassia and to Bahatha?
Does it feel like a dice?
No, it feels like, well, you know this, Bahatha in portrayal is usually an amalgamation of all animals.
Okay. So it's just a
yeah, and it's a very druidic-like faith, which is why you know.
Yeah.
So it does have a certain worldview. So it makes sense for it to be a circle or a...
Yeah. Yeah.
I think you're right, though. I mean, that is a good sign, but... I mean, listen, I did not want to be taken away from where I was taken. Sounds like you were up to something fairly important trying to find your sister. I think we should also tread carefully, because...
The surface is dangerous. This is all a dangerous place. We're in a dangerous place.
I mean, yeah...
How do you know, though?
Well, we don't, but I'm saying we should be careful.
My uncle told me.
The surface in general. Never mind. We'll get to that.
Oh. I get it.
Do you?
Yeah. There was something else here.
Right.
I don't know what was in this one, but there's wax and there's glass.
Oh, wow.
A candle, maybe?
Can we take those with us?
Yeah, just let's steal them. I may take them.
Would it not be considered stealing if we just took something?
I mean, is there any other sign of, we're standing
there
on
ice.
There
is a little mat on the ground.
Ooh.
Which, I'm not going to have you make more religion rolls. You too would know is a prayer mat.
Okay.
Huh.
All right, well, it feels maybe bad to take these from this room.
I'm going to say a prayer.
Okay.
All right.
Okay.
Sure.
Okay. You can carry on with what you were doing. She goes and she kneels down onto the on the prayer mat.
I take a couple steps down the stairs just to try to listen.
By the way, thank you for reminding me that. You start to go down the steps a little bit. I have to do perception checks. Sorry, everybody.
No, you're fine, please.
Perception from everybody.
Okay.
KoKo, advantage from Banana Fan of Faux Fezzeron. Saint, advantage from Vanderslice. Valcorio, advantage from Labrador. Octavius,
thank
advantage
you, Labrador.
From Labrador, but countered by A.G. McLeod.
Oh, no!
You got advantage.
A.G. McLeod.
And Ursula, advantage from Hadrian X.
Take the higher.
Okay, 11
when you have advantage, you
this
take
is
the
perception?
Higher. Correct.
Oh, not good.
That's, okay. 16. Even with advantage, that's a 4.
Okay.
16.
11.
4.
Dirty 20.
Okay, so ooh. You three, there's the slightest, like, shift in the ground and like a little bit of a almost like a something's moving or rumbling.
Is it violent or slight?
No, it's very slight. That's okay. Why these two didn't even notice it.
Okay.
You get down to pray and you're like, oh wait, hold on.
Yeah, you see me like walking out the door slowly.
Did anybody else feel that?
Well, yes, I did.
I did too.
Feel what?
Maybe there'll be an eruption from the bottom, as well as falling from the top.
We should go.
Everybody clear to the sides.
Oh, why are you saying
I don't know, just because I don't know where we are, and I'm standing in this
hallway. Why are we whispering?
I think he said we should whisper.
Who said that?
Because we don't know where we are.
The scale.
We don't know who's surrounding us.
Hello!
Okay,
it's all right.
That's all right.
We're safe. I can heal you.
What is the ground?
You can hear that?
Heal.
Oh, heal them.
Is the ground ice?
What's that?
Is the ground ice?
Oh yeah.
So it's like I can't burrow if I would want to try to burrow.
I'll tell you this. Yes, but you would be at, you know, like 1/4 of your movement speed. Because instead of going through earth, which you're used to, it's ice.
You ever like,
I will say
put
this,
your hand
though,
in a bag of ice for a while? That would hurt.
Yeah.
Ever
oh, do you have a heat pack?
Yeah, I will say this, the heat or the ice in this room is pretty solid. But as you glance down the steps, it gets a little bit more crunchy the lower you go down the steps into the lower area. Okay. This room is solid ice.
Okay.
So yes, it would be almost impossible for you to burrow.
Maybe we should move out.
Yes, stairs.
Owlboy, can you see in the dark?
It's perfectly in the dark, sir.
Okay. I see pretty well in the dark.
I cannot.
Okay,
so
let's hold hands.
Well, I have a light.
That's fine.
Oh, I have a light, and she casts light on her
shield.
Oh wait,
do I have a torch?
Okay.
You do have a torch.
She can light up.
And thank you so much for looking in your pack because you discover
what is
a
happening?
Jar of worms.
What is happening?
So you have your choice. Do you want extra dirty worms or regular dirty worms?
What is happening?
Extra dirty.
I mean, extra dirty.
Okay. Yeah. These can go over here.
Props.
So I find this in my pack.
So you find a jar in your pack that you did not know it was there.
Okay.
It's a jar, and as you kind of pop open the top and look inside, there's soft, rich, well-tilled, rich, like almost like potting soil, and it's filled with worms.
Just in her pack or all of ours?
Just hers.
Wait, what?
I just brought two, so you guys
what's
could share.
What's up? What did you say about it?
Dirt and worms.
It's like potting soil.
Yeah.
It's very rich.
Yeah.
You remember? Do you remember?
Yeah.
Oh.
What are you doing?
I fell right back in.
So she reaches into her pack for a torch and then pulls out this jar instead, pops it open, and there's little wiggling worms in it, and she tastes the dirt.
What do you got there?
You know, Okay.
Yeah.
Would you like to taste this?
Are those worms? I love worms.
Okay, I can always kind of get a sense for what's going on when I can like taste the dirt.
That's incredible.
I know. It's something I kind of just curated myself.
Do it.
Do it? Did you say do it?
Right?
What?
She wants you to eat the dirt, I think.
Or not. If no one wants you to, it's not.
Wait, but where did that come from?
Did you pack lunch? Is that lunch for you?
It immediately reminds you of the Feywild. It all comes flooding back.
Oh, wow.
By the way, you actually are eating one of these worms?
Yeah.
Okay. You feel invigorated.
Oh, wow.
That's so hard. Yes, this is amazing. This reminds me of home. I mean, kind of my home. Not really my home, but like also my home. I kind of grew up in the... It's a long story. Do you want some dirt? Let's see what it I'm makes good. You feel.
I'm freezing cold and worried something's going to explode it from the floor. Oh, but absolutely.
Okay, I can put this back in my pack and we can do this later.
You have your own right there.
Well, what's
hers? Because she gave us this one. Jared.
Do you want a...
No, I'm fine. Thank you.
She gave it to us. I'll try
That's
it.
Really good.
It's really like good.
What does it taste like? Same?
So, the worms are alive, by the way.
Wait a minute.
Sorry. You eat them.
Everyone's eating worms?
Yeah.
All right, not me.
I mean, not me.
Hey, you don't know what it's like in the North Island.
Yeah, this is, I'm like, I guess this is how it is up here.
All of you that eat the worms have a sense of, like, not only invigoration, but also, like, mental fortitude. Like, you feel like you can accomplish anything you set out to do. It's almost like a spiritual pick-me-up.
Oh, those worms are really good. We should be saving these.
Okay, yeah. I'll save the rest of them. I have a whole jar. Okay, so here's what I'm thinking. I think you're on to
something. Ursula does a hug again, but does it more confidently.
Aww.
Sorry.
Sank gives her the biggest hug back. Oh, it's so nice to meet you.
Okay.
You.
Cheers.
Cheers. You guys.
Coco, yes.
Okay. So, okay. I think you were onto something about getting the heck out of here.
Yes, we should go.
Okay.
Because
we felt the ground move. Well, we did. You didn't. But, okay. So here's the thing. I think that this reminds me of, like, I think I, like, fell through a portal or something to get here. And if we all ended up here, this is like a portal. What if it opens up again and sucks us back out somewhere? I don't want to go anywhere else.
Oh, that's a really good point. We should get the...
I don't even know where I am. Do you guys want to get out?
Yeah.
I think if a god brought us here, then we are here for a reason.
Yes, I would like to leave. Okay. Can we leave now, please?
Okay. So you cast light on something.
On my shield.
Okay, yeah. So her shield is now glowing and there's, I believe it's 20 feet of bright light that comes off of her shield.
I'm gonna save my torch, because that's enough light.
Great.
Okay.
All right.
Okay, so you're going down the steps?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Who's going first?
Well, I have the light, so I will go first.
Okay.
I'll be
even
behind
though,
her.
Even though you're used to ducking down because of your size, you can tell by the archway. Yeah. Both of you. It's going to be great for your guys' postures. You don't have to duck down for this
method concert. Actors.
No. Oh, you don't have to.
Instinctually, I still do.
Yeah. The hall is
very tall.
Is tall, it's big, and it's built for someone four times your size.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, it's big.
28 feet?
Yeah.
20. 4 times 7.
So you head down the steps and there's a door. The door is wood. It's frozen over. And it looks ancient. It looks like a crudely made door that could possibly be 100 years old.
How old did the rug look in the idols?
The rug and the idols do not look that old.
Okay.
I thought the Thassia
looked warm. Thassia looks worn, but not hundreds of years
not
old.
Ancient.
Gotcha. Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, I'll try the door.
Okay. What's everybody else doing?
I'm next to you.
I'm behind Saint, hand on my rapier.
Okay. So the marching order right now is Saint, Valcorio, then who?
Otto.
Otto, okay.
I thought.
Okay.
That's a good spot.
KoKo, okay.
I'll be in the back.
Okay.
Tall girls, front and back.
Yeah.
So you reach your hand on this door. Again, ice cold. There's a big iron pull ring. You pull on it and it doesn't open. you push on it and it pushes into the room with a as if it has been frozen shut for who knows how long.
This is a weird question.
Yeah.
Is the structure that like the door is built into, is it solid ice or is it obvious that it was like once wooden or once stone that has been covered in ice? Ice all the way through.
As the door opens, I'm getting to it. Mm-hmm. As the door opens and you peer into this room, it opens up and this area is carved. Ooh, and it's dome-like. Ooh. And your light is 20 feet, but it does definitely bounce off of the surfaces and kind of reflect upwards, so you can see up to the ceiling. The ceiling is 20 feet up. It's even taller. I'm sorry, it's 40 feet up. It's even taller than the room you were just in. And as you're glancing around, you notice that the stalagmites, stalactites, the walls themselves, they all look like it was a natural ice cave that had been carved out further. So you're in an ice cave.
Is it still deathly cold?
Oh yeah. Okay. In fact, it's even colder in this room than the room that you were just in. And that reminds me, thank you, the floor in this room is still ice, but it's cracked in places.
Okay.
Are we able
to
tell?
That makes me nervous.
Yeah, is it thick? Is it thick ice?
It seems pretty thick. It seems pretty thick.
You seem pretty light on your feet.
I'm quick on my feet, but I'm quite heavy.
Oh. Do you want me to go first?
Yes.
Okay. And then KoKo kind of like runs and sort of slides and glides on the
Yeah. Her cape
is like flapping a little bit. She's like, woo! Woo! Oh, okay. And she kind of gets her footing.
Do you see anyone?
Give me a... Do you have dark vision? Do you have infravision?
As an elf, she should, yeah. I think, yeah.
So are you staying within the light?
Kari knows. Yes.
The way I do...
Light is 40 feet. 20 feet 40? Of light and then 20 feet of dim.
I didn't know that's what
beautiful.
It was called.
Yeah. So, beautiful. Yes, you do. You see a pile of furs...
Yeah, it's the whole room, basically.
You see a pile of furs over in this corner right here.
And they don't have the animals in them, do they?
You don't know.
Like
it's at the edge.
Occupied furs.
But it's looks like a big
furs and bones. It's a whole lot.
Pile
of
furs.
Yeah.
Okay.
And flesh.
I see some white fuzzy furry stuff.
You look around the rest of the room. The rest of the room looks pretty open, other than these, the stalactites and stalagmites.
Okay.
And some of these ice chunks sticking up out of the ground have been carved on, and they have weird symbols carved into them that you do not recognize.
So it looks like somebody's definitely been here. They've been doing a little work, a little carving work. It's quite beautiful. I think the ice feels decently safe here. Do you want to try to come out here? If we hold hands, we can just kind of pull each other across and just don't walk, just slide, glide, skate. Skate even.
Yes, I'll go last.
Okay. That's a good idea. Okay, who's next?
Me!
Okay.
And I run, and I slide into your arms.
Oh!
like a penguin, like, on their belly.
Yeah.
Like, yes.
Oh. You nailed it!
Yes!
I'm guessing the rest of you are
Val comes out, but he doesn't slide. He just walks out.
You guys, look at these incredible carvings.
These furs. I'm gonna take one of the furs.
Oh yes, okay. Let's go get the furs.
So you all make your way over to the fur, and just as you get to the fur, the fur begins to move out of the ball that it was kind of tucked into itself, raises two massive blue claws.
Oh no!
and lets out a horrific and immediately attacks you.
Oh!
Whoa. Wait.
Oh, wow.
What, is it a bear?
It's a Yeti.
Oh, oh no!
What?
How oh, boy. Small? We're going, getting real already.
So.
When I was thinking about the first episode, never did I expect to be in the tundra.
Yeah, right?
With a Yeti.
An immediate Yeti, surprise.
That Yeti is huge.
So I'm going to say you all were kind of making your way over.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Okay.
All right, let's roll initiative, shall we?
Oh,
don't forget,
first
you have that
initiative.
Card.
Oh, yeah, we can swap it out.
You do too.
Oh, yeah. I don't even think we go first.
Do advantages?
Yes, please.
KoKo, advantage from Marie Listopad.
Thank you, Marie Listopad.
Saint, advantage from Hadrian X.
Thank you,
Valcorio, advance from advantage from Labrador.
Thank you, Labrador.
Otto, advantage from Labrador.
Woo!
And Ursula, advantage from Hadrian X.
Thank you, Hadrian X.
And I have advantage from Kanata, be my daddy. But it's countered by I love Chris.
Oh, that's nice.
I've got a pretty low initiative.
Got it.
If we want to swap seats.
I've got 16.
12.
11.
Dirty 20.
Oh, that's good. If you want, to go first.
It's honestly. Can we? Do we have to swap it now?
Yes, before initiative.
Okay.
Before battle starts.
And you get a +2, actually, right? Because didn't you?
Yeah,
you started singing.
Special.
They had a +2 to your score, so yours is now 14.
Like randomly, she just starts to sing.
Well, no. When the thing was called out, you were the one who sang.
Oh, just then.
Yes.
Like, I had to activate.
You're the one who's sort of saying, "Let's do the time warp."
Yeah. Okay.
Did you want to go first, or because I know we're both by the Yeti, so it would make sense for
the two of you who are closest to it should probably go first. It's sometimes better for the cleric to go last.
Did anyone beat a 21?
No.
Okay, great.
Definitely not.
So what did I said 12, so 13, 14. 14.
16 for me.
20.
You were 11?
11.
I'm 9.
Oh.
You good, Jared?
Yeah.
Okay.
Who did you guys decide who's going when?
I'll go.
The two of you
should go.
One,
two.
So what's your score now?
You had rolled a 14. I rolled a 16.
So they're swapping.
We're swapping.
What they're saying.
Okay.
Okay, but you're both closer. You can swap with me if you want. So you can go first and second.
I think they're the two highest, aren't they? Because she's now 14?
I'm 16.
The Yeti beat all of you.
Yeah.
Okay, so I'm first, and I'm going to give mine to you.
Okay.
Then you can have mine.
Okay.
So first, second, third, fourth, fifth.
Yeah, sounds good.
So KoKo,
Otto. That made my brain hurt. I know.
It's like adding extra math to Andy.
Then Val?
Yes.
Then Ursula?
Then last. Saint.
Saint and then Ursula.
Yeah.
Katie, you're always going last.
Okay.
It's kind of my thing.
It's like half hibernation mode. It's very cold.
It's really cold. She does feel like it's time to go to bed.
It did.
Hashtag relatable.
By the way, this Yeti does not look like, not that any of you have witnessed very many Yetis, but it does not look like a normal Yeti.
Okay.
Its eyes are glowing red. It has two sets of blue horns that wrap around and curl out. It's built almost like if you took a Yeti and a huge gorilla and sort of blended them together. It's that massive in stature.
Wow.
Okay.
Its claws are blue, its feet are blue, and it's got a little bit of, when it moves, it's almost like its hair or its fur shimmers, especially with the light reflecting off of it from her shield.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
It is going to spend its first action roaring.
Oh no.
Screaming, and that unleashes its primal power of ice. So all targets within 30 feet, which is everybody,
oh no,
must succeed on a DC 13 constitution saving throw.
Okay.
Or take some damage.
Cool.
So we're already doing saving throws.
Yeah.
Constitution advantage. KoKo, advantage from Gateway Guy. Saint,
you.
Advantage from Hadrian X.
Thank you.
Valcorio, advantage from Labrador.
Thank you, Labrador.
Octavius, advantage from Diesel Burger.
Thank you, Diesel Burger.
Ursula, advantage from Hadrian X.
Oh, bad.
Oh, so bad.
Best of two.
Best of two. Yeah. Roll a 20, take the higher.
You are immune to this.
Thank goodness, because I rolled terribly.
15.
I'm sorry, you're resistant to this.
Resistant, not immune. I rolled a 9.
So anybody beat a 13?
Yes. Nice, nice. Yeah. Oh, I'm so the only one who did it. Hey! I'm resistant, so that's great.
Okay. So it's 8 damage, but you're resistant, so you only take 4.
Okay.
The rest of you take nothing.
Wow.
Wow. That was not nearly as cool as I was hoping.
Pretty
however,
cool for us.
Wow,
what do you need?
However, it also has claw attacks.
No. Oh,
so it's going to do one claw attack on you and another claw attack on you.
Oof. You get a claw attack.
Advantage from Shiny Bitboo, countered by Grasp My Hand, and another advantage by Shiny Bitboo, countered by Grasp My Hand.
Thank
so
you.
These are both flat rolls. Hey,
Bitboo and Grasp My Hand.
Man, I'm rolling bad. I'm rolling like Jeff.
You asked like, for it, Jared.
It's like he's here.
This is not fair.
That's so much cool 14? Stuff I could do.
14?
Does that hit you?
It hits. It does? Oh.
I don't think I equipped my armor when we were making her.
Okay.
No.
13 is fine.
Well, I mean, are you wearing your armor?
Yeah, probably.
Okay.
But let's say no.
Wait, even if it's just leather armor, that's still only a 14, though, isn't it?
Yeah, I think leather armor makes it a 14.
Yeah.
Right? Oh, okay. So. We'll say you're wearing your leather armor, but you still get hit.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Because you'd be wearing anything that's going to keep you warm, you'd be wearing that right now.
Put on more clothes.
Yeah. More clothes.
And I only got an 11 on you.
Okay.
That's so that misses.
What is that?
So what you do is your armor class.
Yeah, 15.
Yeah. So if I say, does a 12 hit you, you say no. If I say, I got a 15, that hits.
Okay. We just dragged Kari into this, like, off the street. She has no idea what's happening.
Where am I?
Just
10 you're points right. of slashing damage.
Oh!
Oh!
And another 5 points of cold.
Okay!
Oh my god!
So, oh man, okay.
Yeah, this
so,
thing hits hard.
Okay.
Not only does it hit you, but you feel this icy breeze waft over you. Oof. At the same time that does not seem natural. Like it's almost like it's expelling cold when it hits.
While it hits. Okay.
And it hits you hard enough to where it knocks you back. Not prone, but it does knock you back.
Good.
A good
five. It's not a bad thing necessarily.
And that is its turn.
Woof.
KoKo, you are up.
May I ask?
Yeah.
How good is the Yeti's eyesight?
Give me a nature roll and I'll tell you.
Okay.
You are right next to it.
I know, but...
Maybe it did, hasn't had a haircut.
I have an idea.
No, true.
But I have an idea.
KoKo, you have a advantage from JT Justice 1.
Thank you, JT.
Oh my god, I can't see. Yeah.
Okay. So,
roll another and take that. But that's pretty good. Great.
So 16. Nature. And then wait, nature?
Which is 0.
Oh, 0. Plus 1?
Yeah.
Okay, so 17.
17. So, this does not seem like a normal Yeti.
Right.
But from what you know about these types of creatures, they have a really good sense of smell, because that's what, and senses in general, because that's what they use to hunt with.
Okay.
So think of it as being just as much animal as it is beast.
Hmm. Okay, so I have to decide what to do.
Yeah. You get a move, an action, and a bonus action. And a reaction, but the reaction is really just like based off of things that happen around you and when something gets triggered.
You want to get away from it, you can disengage, but that will take your whole action to do that.
Wow.
Or you can attack and try to run away, but it will probably try to swipe at you if you do that.
Mm-hmm. You didn't take that much damage, right?
Which you, I mean, you haven't taken any damage yet, so... Maybe that's worth it.
Yeah, I think.
What would KoKo do?
What would KoKo do?
Well, I feel like KoKo would yell to
Saint.
I almost said Fahima.
Wrong show.
We're gonna do it. I mean, it's almost happened to me a couple
Saint,
times.
To because you're still holding. What were you doing
a
with
shield
your shield?
And my warhammer. It has light.
Light. Your shield has light?
Yeah.
Okay. That's so cool. I was going to say, I think that KoKo would lunge for the knees.
Sure.
Yeah. And grab her two short swords.
Yes.
And then, but at the same time, yell to Saint to try and blind the Yeti.
Sure.
With
the
light.
What do you say?
What?
What do you say?
Oh. Saint, you pretty basic.
It's very clear what she's saying.
Right. Yeah. Do you get that?
Listen, I'm trying to fight at the same time. There's only so much I can do.
I'm so sorry, I was checking something.
So, KoKo, you have advantage from two advantages, both from Hadrian X.
Thank you.
Go ahead and roll your two short sword attacks. You get two d20s. Oh, yeah, and you get the higher of the two.
Oh, that 20!
Yeah!
That'll hit. Roll for your other attack.
That's gonna hit.
So 14 plus your bonus to hit.
Five, I believe. Yeah, plus five, it's a 19.
19, okay, so the second one hits as well. I know you have two weapon fighting.
Yeah.
So that means that you get to roll double dice for your first one. Uh-huh. And it's a short sword, so it's a d6 plus your dexterity bonus.
Okay.
So you get to do that twice. Right. You get to roll the dice twice, but you only add your bonus damage once.
Okay.
You have a math wizard next to you.
Plus
so.
Three. Yeah. So.
Oh, add them together or take the
correct.
Highest?
No. Okay. Take the, yes. Okay. So nine points on the first one. Nine kay. Slashing.
Great.
And then on the second one, roll another d6, and you get to add just three one? For that as well.
Or
yes.
Two.
Yeah, just one.
Okay.
Three. And so that's another six. So that's 15.
Doesn't add on this. Oh, it does add.
She does because she's got two weapons.
Yep. And you're right. Six. Okay. So 15 total.
D4. Roll a d4.
Okay.
Which
one's that?
The little triangle boy.
Yeah, that one.
Yeah.
She, because of
three.
An additional three psychic damage.
Right.
Because.
So anytime you, this goes for the future as well. Anytime you see KoKo fight. Not only does she move with a certain amount of grace to her swings, but you notice that every time she cuts, it's almost like there's a secondary slice or gust of wind that does extra damage to at least one of the blows that she hits with.
That's cool.
Yeah.
So she just did 18 points of damage. Yeah.
So you slice up this thing's rear left hindquarters,
okay.
And it roars in pain. Mm-hmm. You can immediately tell that when it puts its two claws down onto the ice, that it's just as good on four limbs as it is on two. It's not a bipedal yeti. It's a knuckle dragon.
Now he's all silverback in it.
Yeah. But you did do a lot of damage, which is great.
Yeah.
That's always good.
How does it look? How does it look?
It's still going.
Oh.
Yeah,
I was going to say, there's definitely this moment of KoKo, who's been...
pretty sweet.
Kind of weird, kind of sweet. Eating worms a moment, eating dirt and worms a moment ago, just drags out two short swords and does serious damage to this thing.
Yeah, that's pretty cool.
There's definitely a moment with Val where it's like...
Oh, she knows what she's doing.
I may have misread her. Okay.
I mean, she's still a wood elf. She's still... Yeah.
For sure.
Yeah, she knows what she's doing.
All right.
Especially when battling like a bigger beast.
Got it.
Otto, it's your turn.
Oh gosh.
Oh, you poor baby.
Yeah, and taking all of this damage, Otto staggers back, thinking about their training that they've had, and whips out their crossbow, and aims it at the Yeti's like chest, like trying to do a heart strike.
Sure.
Whoa. And how it's do you look?
Got
you,
a big furry chest.
So Otto looks terrified, like their eyes fear, but also like you see this moment where like almost like military, like
your training kicks
my
in.
Training kicks in. Mm. Their eyes narrow and they their crossbow is fairly large for how small they are, so it's a little like bigger, and it looks very homemade but well crafted.
Wow.
Just and hiding in your feather pockets?
Yeah, hiding in my feathers.
Wow.
My side.
Cool. You're pretty hurt too, right?
Yeah.
Like pretty badly hurt?
Pretty badly hurt. I have 9 hit points left.
Oh! Bloody,
so,
for sure.
So like trembling, I take aim.
Sure, great.
Do I have advantage?
Yes, thank you for reminding me. You do, from Fail Waffle.
Yay!
Oh my gosh, thank you so much, because that was gonna be bad for me. Does a 16 hit?
It does.
Nice.
Okay.
So you can roll your crossbow damage, and I believe because you have an ally within 5 feet, you get your sneak attack.
Yeah, she's engaged.
Yes.
Coco's still engaged with the egg.
You got any rogue questions?
Experience rogue. Not the devil.
That is 2 + 7 + 6.
15.
15. So 15 points of damage. I'm going to use my bonus.
What's your dex?
15, 16.
Plus 3.
18. 18. So you both did 18 points of damage.
Whoa! Yeah. 18 points of damage. I use my bonus action to hide.
Sure. Do you want to move?
Yes, I want to move behind. Oh, how far can I go?
Saint's also trying to make eye contact with you.
Okay, I'm gonna go kind of where by Saint is and hide.
Oh, you want to go back?
Yeah.
Like here? This is Saint. Saint's the big purple.
Are you waiting for her to like? Are you waiting for them to blink twice?
I want to go behind this.
Well,
she's
tag me in.
Yeah, I
want to
go behind that rock.
She's noticed that she's 10, that 15, Otto is very hurt.
Yeah, you can get back there. No problem. Mm-hmm.
Is it possible to hide from one enemy and not from your friend? Like, is that like?
Yeah.
Yeah, that could be part of your hide check, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So go ahead and make your stealth roll. And you have advantage from Fail Waffle again.
Yay.
Thank you, Waffle, my hero. Okay, that is. Okay. I'm so stealthy. 17 plus 7.
24.
Okay. As far as you know, you are very well hidden.
Okay.
Yeah. I will say that. Because Saint was watching you.
Okay.
Saint knows where you went and where you hid, but I'm gonna say Val and Ursula, you don't know exactly where Otto went to.
Okay.
They just kind of disappear around the ice pillar. Cool. Anything else?
No.
Okay. Val, it's your turn.
All right. Okay.
Wait, what do I do with this when it's done?
So. Oh, I'll
eat
take
it.
Okay. Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
I'll eat it. I'll put it.
Eat it just like the worms.
Dirt. Yeah. Cook it in my dirt first.
Val is starting to rethink this really weird group of people he's suddenly around, having watched the two of them.
The Cosmobolt did some damage.
Oh, for sure. Yeah. No, having watched the two of them just like lay waste to this Yeti.
The Yeti's definitely sucking air through its chest.
All right. Yeah, here we go. And so Val draws his rapier and goes, and charges forward, basically trying to be almost side by side with KoKo.
Nice. Side by side like that?
Give me a little bit of an angle. So
here?
Right around there is good. And
so you're going right up to this thing face to face.
Sure.
Okay.
Come on, big boy. And Val draws his rapier, and but with a kind of a very nice duelist's flourish, basically lunges right for its chest.
Okay.
Basically trying to make that hole in its chest bigger.
Yeah. Roll your attack.
Nice.
Advantage, disadvantage.
Oh, yes. Val, advantage from my Michael Rose.
Thank you, Michael. Yes, that's a dirty 20.
Wait, who is? Oh, Michael Rose!
Dirty 20 will hit.
Nice.
And while you're adding that up, I'm going to read off some balloons.
Yay.
Thank you for the balloons. We love them. Cosmo wants cuddles. A jar full of
Cosmo
bees.
Cosmo wants cuddles.
Me too.
Sitar. Aelvar, A-E-L-V-A-R. If I butcher any of these, just message me in Discord and I'll fix it.
Jared knows Jeff's pain now.
Dazmir, this Justin, Gamer Realm, thank you so much for those balloons.
Yay!
And we got some more sprouted potatoes.
Oh my goodness.
A sprouted potato by Angel Devilson, which unlocks a Force of Nature card.
Oh!
So is this the next level?
Yes.
Okay.
This is perfect.
It's even warmer clothes.
Yeti dung discovered. Is it a giant, gross, disgusting, smelly pile of Yeti poop? Yes. Is it also very effective fuel for a fire or repelling unwanted predatory animals? Also yes.
Ooh.
Any PC who makes a DC 12 survival check knows how to use the Yeti dung in a beneficial manner.
Okay.
And I'm gonna say that there's three uses of Yeti dung that are in this.
Three uses of Yeti dung. So we all need to roll a survival check?
Just mark down, somebody mark down that there's three uses of Yeti dung.
Okay.
And when you want to use it,
okay.
It's a DC 12 survival.
All right, cool.
Survival. Okay.
Who wants the card? Who wants the Yeti dung?
I want to look at it.
I rolled max damage for a 13 with one stab.
Great. I love it.
13 points of damage. How hurt is it looking after that?
I'll tell you in a second. It is bloodied, wheezing, starting to collapse, but not.
Okay. Out, not no. Yeah. Conscious. All right. Then. Yeah. That's.
It definitely looks like it has some fight left in it.
Okay. I'm gonna stay where I am then. Yeah. I'm gonna stay there, basically next to KoKo.
Okay.
Yeah.
Saints.
Yeah.
Okay. Couple questions.
I want to know more about the Yeti.
I do want to know more about the Yeti poo poo. I definitely want to try to use that.
By the way, I read some survival books before we started all of this, so there's going to be a lot of
chapters on Yeti. Yeah.
Wait, is that just for like if we want to start a fire later?
You're the ranger. You tell me.
I thought that's what that was for, but you want to use it now?
Yeah.
Okay.
How do you use it now?
We'll see.
It says it's for repelling unwanted predatory animals, and that's definitely a predatory animal that is unwanted.
Wouldn't it be weird if your own dung? Yes. Like repelled. Well, I guess it does.
That's I would say, don't make me say this.
You know you be that because the dung is this Yeti's dung, it probably won't repel it. You would know that.
I'm sure there's a creative way.
I mean, I wouldn't want my own poop thrown in my face.
Look at this mess you made.
I mean, if you light it on fire,
yeah, if you light it on fire,
it feels like it would make the smell way worse.
Oh, for sure.
Are there any stalactites above the Yeti?
Yes. Sure. There are stalactites and stalagmites all over this ice cave.
Uh-huh. And this dung seems like maybe it's hard enough that if I chucked it at the stalactite,
I mean, part of it is frozen, I guess.
Might crack it off.
You want to hurl the frozen Yeti dung at the ceiling?
Maybe.
It's 40 feet up, so you'd really have to vault it up there.
I love your imagination.
She's so much closer to the ceiling.
Okay, I got another.
I'm not saying she can't.
I have another question, and then I'm going to try it.
Okay.
Are there any cracks in the ice between me and the Yeti?
There are small cracks.
But not big ones?
Correct. In this whole... You all would be dealing with like difficult terrain and stuff if it was really broken up.
Got it. Mm-hmm.
These are like small lines. Like in every movie when someone walks out onto a frozen lake where it just begins to start to crack, that's what you're seeing.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. It's still freaking Saint out a little bit to see the little hairline cracks because she's 200 pounds. So
yeah.
So she's
sure.
At least.
But this
pounds.
Yeti's probably two or three times that and it's not breaking through.
That's true.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So, can I do this? Let me find my spell.
I believe in you.
Can I do this? Can I cast?
I say yes.
I cast throw dung.
Can I cast Spiritual Weapon, which is a flock of sparrows, and hold my shield up and try to aim the beam into the Yeti's eyes, as KoKo has suggested.
Oh, thanks for remembering.
And then while it's blinded, use the distraction of my Spiritual Weapon sparrows, and maybe they can even carry the dung.
That's
carry the dung in their little feet, and they can chuck it.
So let me ask you this. What is the more important part of this maneuver? Is it the trying to distract and blind the Yeti, or the throwing of the dung?
Blind the Yeti.
Okay.
Yeah.
So that's going to be your action.
Okay.
To do that.
Okay.
And then your bonus action would be to hurl the spiritual weapon and push the dung up towards the ceiling.
Which is a bonus action, so I think I should be able to do that.
Right. And you can cast that like 60 feet away.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. It's a melee attack against a creature, but I would maybe do the melee attack against the stalactite to try to get it to fall.
Yes. So no dung is involved, because the dung's on the ground.
I would like some dung to be involved. If we can work the dung into the situation.
The dung's on the ground, so you'd have to somehow get the dung onto the sparrows and then up into the air. So just logistically.
All right. I can pass on the dung. Maybe you can use the dung.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, he's got a whole dung idea.
So many dung ideas.
For your action, I'm going to say you're effectively doing like a taunt, even though it's not really a taunt, you're blinding it.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm going to have you roll intimidation for that to try to get its attention.
Sure.
Okay.
There isn't a skill for blindy-blindy with a
blindy. Oof. Do I have advantage?
Blindy-blindy.
Not a very good skill. Fine.
Saint, you have advantage from Dusky.
Thank you, Dusky.
Not Dunsky. Dung.
Oh, that's... Ooh, not great. 7.
Okay. all it essentially does, instead of like actually blinding it, is just drawing its attention towards you.
Oh no.
So
like, hey, over here.
It seems to want to face off with you, but it also has people in its way. Go ahead and roll your attack for your bonus action of striking the stalactite.
Okay.
Stalactite.
So I do, on a hit, so I have to roll.
Yeah,
it's a spell attack.
Yeah. And do I have advantage?
You do, from Hadrian X.
Thank you, Hadrian! My goodness.
Oh, my rolls.
Oh, God, one of those is a natural one. Go away.
Don't even look at that.
Dirty 20. Yes.
That hits. Yeah. You do have to do enough damage to break the stalagmite off the ceiling. So
okay.
Roll your damage.
So I roll a 1d8, and
You need 5 points of damage to break it off.
Come on, you got this.
1d8 plus my spellcasting modifier.
And then it will fall 40 feet onto the Yeti.
Ouch.
So that'll do some damage.
Okay,
I might
cool.
even drop it. You just gotta do 5 to break it off.
It's a d8 plus your wisdom score, yeah.
Alright, yes. That is my bonus action. What is that? What is that number?
Is that a 2?
Is that a 2? Mm-hmm.
Is that a 5? That's a 2.
I think it's a 5. Oh, it's a 2. I think it's 2. 2 plus 3.
Oh, that's 5.
Yay!
So, you
Took
break
a while
off
to get
the
there.
Stalagmite. It cracks. You don't think it's going to fall at first, but then we're going to say one more sparrow just kind of pecks it. And it snaps off and it comes careening down. And the Yeti is just about ready to eviscerate Val when this thing crashes down on top of its head, splitting part of its head open and cracking one of its horns.
Whoa!
And let's do some damage.
Whoa!
Let's see how much it does.
Wonder if
it's
more of
dropping
horns.
At least 6, 7 plus another 4 is 11. That would be 8. So it doesn't die, but its eyes roll up in the back of its head and it falls unconscious.
Oh,
yes!
You did exactly
teamwork.
as much damage as you needed to do. You did 60 points and it had 60 points, so it's still breathing, it's still alive, it's just laying there unconscious. And that's where we'll take our intermission.
Whoa, boy.
So much golf clapping.
So much golf clapping.
We're doing it.
Oh my goodness.
Alright.
And we're going to intermission.
Sean's up there. Hey Sean. Buddy. We love you.
Thank you.
And we're back.
Whee!
Just a slow fade in on your
We weren't talking about bizarre, random conversations that have nothing to do with this, but we're back in the game now. So the last moment that we had right before we went to break was this large hunk of ice that you broke off with your spiritual weapon, and it as it cracked and fell down and collided with this Yeti's skull, it broke its horn, knocked it unconscious, and there's just a big, heavy thwomp as it careens down and crashes to the ground in front of you two.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. The ice doesn't break or anything that you're standing on, but you can immediately tell just by the way the chest of this creature is heaving that it's still alive. It's just unconscious.
Yeah.
Should I kill it?
Pretty injured. Right? Because I was next in initiative,
yes.
Even though the combat's over,
yeah. Mm-hmm.
I've just grabbed a piece of the dung and throw it at it.
Yes!
You didn't even light it on fire.
It was magical dung.
Throw it. Okay. I imagine that doesn't use it and expend a use. I just throw it.
Oh, okay.
I
don't know. You can always, if you really want to.
I'm just going
to
go pick it up.
You can collect the dung after you throw
it. I'm so sorry. Yeah. I'm so sorry.
I'll put it on my fishing net.
Yeah, some of it does kind of splatter on Val as it whisks by him, landing on the Yeti, but yeah.
Was that Yeti dung?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, it was. But right. We should save it.
Sure, if you say so.
You don't know. You never know.
Is it dead?
Are you all right?
No.
Oh, we need to get you healed up.
Otto comes around the corner here.
Quite a shot there, little guy.
Yeah, you can see that where the Yeti's claw raked up her front side.
Did anybody else get hurt?
No, I'm fine.
No.
Okay.
No.
I'm fine, probably.
You don't look all right.
Yeah, you're not fine.
And she, Saint, once again casts Healing Word on
Great.
Otto.
Go ahead and roll your dice.
Is it a d4?
Yeah.
It's a d4. Yeah, 1d4 plus my spellcasting modifier. So do you want to roll?
Oh, you could roll it. I was...
Nothing. Never mind. Continue.
I was not doing anything.
Okay, so that
What are the rest of you doing while she's healing?
Oh, we can do
six. I'm basically...
Okay.
We're out of combat now.
Okay, because I was like, wasn't it...
Yeah.
Okay.
Technically, it would be Ursula's turn next, but when combat ends, then you go back to regular role-playing.
Oh, see, to me, this is very much like a slasher movie where I'm definitely like...
Traumatized?
Like, no, I definitely am like, he's still alive. You have to like tie him up or kill him or something because he's going to get back up.
You can do that.
I was going to say, I mean, that's this. As you're saying this, yeah, Val has still got his sword out and is kind of like...
don't you think we should do something?
They looked kind of weird though, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, as you're standing over this thing and you can look at it closely, you see that it's been morphed in some way. Not that any of you know a lot about Yetis, because none of you are from this far north.
Yeti land.
Yeti land.
Yeah,
Yeti land. Colloquially known as Yeti land. Yeah. That's right.
From what you've heard, read, studied, oral traditions, what have you, never have you heard of a Yeti getting this big, this strong, and with the red eyes and the double set of horns, it strikes you as being almost like an abomination in some way.
Okay.
Yeah.
Is there a...
Okay. I mean, Yetis are typically fierce. They're territorial, they're hunters, they'll eat you. But this one seems more so.
I'm keeping my sword pointed at it, but I'm also circling around it, basically. Was it protecting anything? Was it like, it was just a pile, looked like a pile of furs to us.
Yes, it was curled up in a ball and you're guessing it was probably sleeping.
Are they solitary creatures?
No.
I would like to.
She did say fudge. Nicely
done. Good job. Family show.
Fudge is delicious.
You're
just saying facts over there.
Have we seen these doors yet over here?
You when you walk to here, because you have, you said 40 dim light, 5, uh-huh. 10, 15, 20. Yeah, you can see them. The two archways.
Are they open like they are on the map?
Yes.
And are they, the Yeti would be able to fit through them?
Barely.
Barely, okay.
Yeah.
Are there any other tracks? Is anyone good at tracking them?
Although I will say that they're incredibly tall. They're even taller than what you see here. Mm-hmm. This looks like they're, you know, 15, 20 feet tall. They're much taller.
So much stooping tonight. Everybody just can't fit through doors.
Well, everyone's kind of talking. Ursula is just going to go, like, walk around the Yeti and, like, kind of in her curious bear fashion.
Sure.
See if there's anything.
I think I'm going to wander around and just make sure that there aren't more of these.
Right. Does that sound like a good idea?
Yeah, okay.
Okay, I'm going to do it.
Okay, so are you, like, medicine check on this thing, or like, or what? What are you trying to ascertain?
I'm just curious, because it, like, again, would I know that this isn't a normal Yeti? I would
roll
I
nature. Know that. Okay. I think nature is gonna cover this. Ursula, advantage from Hadrian X.
Ooh, Hadrian X. Thank you. And that one, so 18.
Nice.
Ooh.
It seems to be infused. Yes, it is a naturally big Yeti, like male, you know, hardcore alpha Yeti.
Okay. Like
fully grown. Yes.
Okay.
But it also it feels like it's been infused with something in addition to its natural. Monstrous ways.
Okay.
Because a primal Yeti that this is, is a monstrosity.
Right. It's you also said it's morphing into something. Right?
It's not morphing. It's been morphed. It's been.
Oh, I see.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's been like
It's been changed in some way.
Mm-hmm. Okay. It doesn't have anything on it.
No.
That's also as there's
I mean, there's like probably
souvenir
bone laying around it from something that it ate, and maybe some, you know, like scraps of like cloth, maybe some tissue that didn't get totally sucked off the bone.
I meant like Kleenex.
Yeah. My brain did too.
He's having a rough night.
Tell me more.
he's got that sensitive.
Okay. Watching Lifetime.
Yeah. Okay.
It's life choices.
Won't take anything then.
So I don't like while KoKo is exploring the cave. I just want to say I don't like the idea of killing it in cold blood. I think we should leave it and move on. But I'm a bit nervous about it getting through the door there. So maybe we can block it on the way out.
You can roll survival. You're searching the room, right?
Mm-hmm.
Go ahead and roll survival.
Who, me?
Yes.
Okay.
Advantage from Hadrian X.
Thank you. Oh, no.
That's a one. You do have to roll again.
Oh, all right.
Oh, no.
Oh, no.
Oh, no.
Not great. You're pretty good at survival.
Oh, yeah. 5, 10. Plus,
okay,
yeah.
So you see lots of tracks.
Okay.
And you're trying to piece them together to figure out what could belong to what, but there's so many of them, and there's a lot of Yeti tracks that you can't really piece one out from another. You don't find any other Yetis here, but you can tell that there have been Yetis in this area, as well as other creatures, or people, or both.
Mm. Okay.
Yeah.
So KoKo runs back to the group. Okay. You guys, okay, I checked everything out as much as I could, and there are so many tracks. Some I don't even recognize, but there definitely are other Yeti tracks that seem like a slightly different size than this foot.
So we should be really sneaky, then. Yeah,
we should definitely keep our voices down.
Yetis, I'm just gonna say, Yetis aren't really known to, I'm sorry, thank you. Yetis aren't really known as big, like, worshippers, right? I mean, I'm not really known, I don't know much about Yetis, but
what are you wondering?
Well, because we just came, the room we just came from had idols and seemed to be like a temple of sorts, like a prayer circle, and then we just run into this guy who does not look like a big prayer type. I mean, I could be wrong.
But what if he was protecting?
Yes,
he was,
he's a guardian.
Yes.
Maybe, all right, I suppose.
And maybe there are other guardians.
But all you saw was Yeti tracks,
maybe,
right?
This was the first test of the god, and we've just passed it.
Oh, we did just pass it.
I want to laugh at you, but you did just make celestial sparrows appear out of the sky and drop a rock on its head, so I'm gonna think maybe you're right.
I think we could laugh together.
Okay.
No, okay.
Right. I try.
You look over and you'll see that Ursula is like rubbing up against the Yeti.
Oh.
Like getting all in there.
Trying to get its scent on you.
Oh my gosh. You might want to do this.
You could use Yeti dung to do that.
Oh really?
That's exactly what people do.
Oh my gosh.
You want to smell like the animal that you're trying to impersonate.
Right. Well, because they have an incredible
smell. We're going to use
smell,
this Yeti dung to do everything but what the cards said it was for.
You don't have to, I'm not saying you have to smear Yeti dung on you. What you're doing is working. I'm saying if you want to take it to another level, you could.
If you all want to do a little cuddle with the Yeti, it might help. Just if there's more around.
I think it's a good idea.
They're known for having a really good sense of smell, and it would help.
Okay, let's do it.
It's a really great idea.
KoKo starts rubbing.
So everyone's rubbing themselves against the Yeti?
Yeah. Yeti.
Yeah.
Okay.
You really gotta get in there, is my experience.
I'm trying. Sure. Yeah.
Its fur is thick and matted, and you actually have to, Ursula's right, you actually have to get your hands up underneath the fur, because where the oils of the skin
right in
the
armpit.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, you gotta really get in there and rub that on yourself if you want to. So everybody that wants to do this, it seems like everybody.
We're all wiggling.
Make a survival check.
Val, as he's doing it somewhat like cautiously, but he's got his dagger out and is like ready to stab this thing.
That's good.
Like if it moves again.
It's definitely still. It's still alive.
Okay.
KoKo, advantage from Hadrian X.
Thank you.
Advantage from Hadrian X.
Thank you.
Valcorio, advantage from Edmonton is not that bad.
Did I insult Edmonton at some point?
Octavius, advantage from Tim Finn.
Thank you.
And Ursula, advantage from Hadrian X.
Yay, I got my first nat 20.
Yay.
You really smell like
that. Glad other people
are good. Oh, yeah. Juicy.
So, six.
That checks out. That checks out.
So, Valcorio is the only one that doesn't really smell like Yeti by the time this is done.
You're 23. Yeah. 21.
Yeah, y'all are great. You really get in there, you're like massaging the Yeti. Val's just sitting there with a dagger waiting for it.
Just kinda, gently rocking.
It's like a half hug. Yeah. It's just kind of like.
Well, Saint, you mentioned that we shouldn't kill it. And I really appreciate that because that would just be cruel.
We should just bury it. Not to its face so it could breathe. We should want it to breathe, but if we bury it, it'll be harder for it to get up if it needs to chase us. So I think we should just cover it in snow.
Snow.
We could.
Okay.
If we had a source of heat, we
all
could.
All of you at this point feel the.
Okay, we could just go. Or we could just run. We could just run, probably. Yeah, let's go.
Okay.
And you notice the little cracks in the ice start to break open.
No.
We gotta run that way.
Saint freezes.
But sneaky.
Come on,
okay, so you guys are making your way over to the arch?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
What's the marching order?
Saint is not moving.
Ursula will push Saint.
Okay.
I'll
be near the front with Octavius.
I'm just worried about the ice.
I mean, you guys can go through different doors if you want. Like, let me know which one you're going
through. Do they lead to the same place?
It appears so, yeah.
I didn't know if there was some trick you were saying. You offered two different doors.
I mean, I'm a tricky DM.
I know.
Don't trust me.
All right, Val will wait. Is it still light on the other side, or is it dark on the other side of those doors?
It's dark.
Okay, I will wait at the... Your left.
Your light
door.
Is all of your light is coming from that
coming
shield.
Coming from Saint. You can
How long
see
does
the
that
dark,
last?
So, right?
Hour.
Okay.
So, do you want to go first?
Saint.
I'm coming. I'm just going to go very slowly.
If you start to notice a really fast rumble, you have to run because that's what they taught us in school. You have to run faster than the avalanche. Remember that.
Yes. Okay.
And then
shine it over here.
All right.
I walk through the door.
Okay, so the two people that are in front, Val.
I'm holding at the door.
Okay.
Because I can't see.
You can because there's light coming from the shield.
Got it. All right.
You just can't see very far.
And I reach out my hand.
Otto and Val, you can give me perception checks to take in the room.
Oh, it's so terrible.
As you step into the room, I know you're not stepping into the room. Mm-hmm. Otto, yeah. As you step into the room, your talon, your foot, mm-hmm. plunges into ice cold water that's ankle deep.
Oh no.
And you have that little packet on you.
Uh-huh.
So you're not freezing, awesome. But it's freezing cold water.
Okay.
And if you didn't have that packet, you'd be in trouble right now.
Oh.
Go ahead and give me perception checks. Octavius, mm-hmm. Advantage from Ashjor.
Thank you,
and
Ashjor.
Val, advantage from City Racing Girl.
Thank you, City Aww. Racing Girl. Okay, all right. 16.
19.
Okay, so are you using your dark vision or are you using natural light?
I'm using my dark vision.
Okay, with your dark vision, because it's 120 feet, right? Mm-hmm. Wow. You see a lot. Actually, let's do you first, Val, since sure. you don't have dark vision. Yep. You can see frozen in a block of ice, a frost giant. A frost giant that is approximately 25, 30 feet tall.
Okay.
Old, scraggly beard, thick bear hides on its shoulders, a robe, bluish white skin with a white beard. Its eyes are closed and it's holding this staff, completely frozen in a block of ice. Right next to it is a massive cave bear. Huh. Cave bears in this world are kind of like grizzly bears that mainly live in caves that are even bigger than grizzly
yeah.
bears.
Yeah, a dire grizzly bear.
Thank you.
Yeah.
That's what you see. Also frozen in ice. In this fierce, almost like aggressive, angry pose.
Cool, I have a question for you, if I might.
Yeah.
About the bear, since this is a brand new world to us, yeah. and we're kind of just learning about the animus and yeah. the difference between animals. What's the difference between Ursaka and the cave bear in terms of sentience and... And
as far as you know, the bear is a bear, and Ursaka is a person.
Right.
So that they it's have, an animal.
Correct.
Fully.
Correct.
Okay.
It's not a humanoid.
As far as you know, there's no half animus. You're either animal or person.
Person who looks like or comes from an animal.
Correct.
So you'll always specify if something is animus.
Yes.
And that's how we know that it's like the same sort of PC that we are.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Or not PC, but you know what I'm saying.
I get what you're saying. Yeah. Good question. And if we do a cooldown on Monday, we can talk about it further. So tune in for the cooldown. Otto, what did you get?
A 19.
19. Okay, so you see a lot. You see, and I turn these around facing out so that the camera can get them. You see a remoras, which is this giant creature.
Oh, beautiful.
You see two large, we're gonna call them dire reindeer.
Mm-hmm.
Covered in like thick fur. One appears to be male, the other one appears to be female. However, even though they're sitting like this on the mat, they're actually hung up as if they were slaughtered, like
okay.
meat. Frozen in a block of ice, the remoras frozen in a block of ice. And the remoras is massive. This, I don't know if you can get a close up here. On this.
Lift it up towards the camera. All right, here we go.
Oh wait.
All right, pull it in front of you.
Do that?
There we go, look at that beautiful thing.
Now I do that.
Whoa.
There you go. Yeah, it looks like a massive
centipede.
Yeah.
Bug.
It's yeah. real upsetting.
But
gross.
It's indigenous to this area.
Okay.
It burrows underground.
In the ice.
Yeah. It's nasty. It's not something you ever want to fight. You also see pillars.
Mm-hmm.
The pillars are actually carved ice. It's not natural. I mean, it's natural that the ice is there, but they've been carved to have a pillar-like appearance. Again, covered in these markings. All the way, not all the way up to the ceiling, but quite a ways.
Okay.
So there are signs of like civilization in that there's carved things, there's,
yes.
You said the reindeer are hung up as
yes.
if they were, as if they were hunted and fed upon.
They've been killed and then hung up like you would hang up a deer to bleed it out.
Mm.
Got it.
But they're frozen.
But they're also
in a block of ice.
So we don't know how long it's even been there.
Correct.
Right. Okay.
You also see a narrow bridge of ice that stretches from here to there over a crevasse in the ground, a split open, we'll call it a ditch, but it's a deep ditch, that's filling with water. And as you glance around in this room, everything is starting to melt. You see water dripping down from the ceiling, along the walls, and it's all flowing and collecting into this little underground, not underground, but lower elevation crack or fissure in the ground. A lot of water is flowing down on this wall over here, which is why we have this waterfall here, and flowing off of that as if it's collecting across the ceiling and leaking down onto the floor. And even though you're standing in this ankle deep water, you can see it pouring down into this opening.
Oh, okay. So the water is moving.
Yes.
Like, okay.
It's draining somewhere. It's not that deep yet, but it is filling. Okay. It's draining, but not fast enough to where it doesn't start to fill.
Am I able to see the faces of the frost giants?
Yes. The one near you? Yes. You also, because it's 120 feet, right? Yeah, I mean, you can see all the way across the room. You see a huge female frost giant, completely frozen in a block of ice, wearing thick, ornate fur robes, a fur skirt, massive, what appears to be like a white dragon skull on her shoulder, holding a staff with a huge blue gem in it, just like this miniature is right here. Crown with dragon teeth coming up out of the top of the crown. And even though she has her hand up and she looks like she's holding like a little ball of fire or something like that in her hand, she's actually holding a orb in her hand.
Okay. Gorgeous.
And she is pretty.
Yeah.
By all standards.
Big Tilda Swinton energy.
At the base of this platform that she's resting on, is this massive alien looking blue cat, just like you see here, just like that miniature, covered in crude metal armor. It looks like metal plates that have been ripped off of maybe a dwarf. You're not quite sure, because frost giants and dwarves tend to not get along. But you know, like most of you know that frost giants are not as advanced as other people are. Like, as far as giants go, they're not like a fire giant or a storm giant or a cloud giant where they make their own material. They're more like Vikings. They raid, they take what they need, what they want. And the world is theirs for the taking.
Oh, okay.
That's their general mindset.
And he's frozen too?
Yes. No, he's not frozen, he rips your face off. No, he's this giant, but the cat doesn't look like anything you've ever seen or heard of ever. It looks completely foreign to this world.
What are we doing here?
And it's frozen in ice. Lastly, and this is probably the most important thing that you see, next to this woman, this frost giant queen, there is a big chunk of ice that has been shattered and broken open, and something has broken out of it and gone somewhere. And you can see big chunks of ice, that's what this is.
Okay.
Resting on the ground. We're talking like, you know, bowling ball size hunks of ice that have broken off and have scattered across the ground down in front of the area that's been shattered.
So broken wall there, that's the only exit we see?
Well, you don't see it.
Oh, you're right, I don't.
And with your 19, there's a wall here, by the way. This is just open so that the camera can see. Yeah. But you see two broken doors. In fact, when you look over that way, the wind blows and they fall off. Like so. They fall inward. And a gust of wind blows through this whole cave, and all of you, except for you, need to give me constitution saves.
Ooh. Because of the gust of wind?
Yep.
Yeah, because it's a wind chill hitting ice cave.
Right, right.
KoKo, advantage from Dusky.
Saint,
advantage from Hadrian X.
Thank you.
Valcorio, don't need to roll. Otto, advantage from USN Rhett.
Thank you.
And Ursula, advantage from Tim Finn.
Thanks, Tim Finn.
Check to see if that.
That nat 20.
Yeah.
Wow. Wow. So warm.
Yeah, your little sachet is helping you out quite a bit.
That is what it's called, the sachet, but it just still sounds like.
Sachet. It doesn't sound like a real word. It sounds like a walk.
Your little sachet.
It's only right now. It's only a DC 10. Did anybody not make DC 10? Okay, so. You all shiver, you all freeze, and it, except for you, your scales just kind of tighten up on you. Which, by the way, you've never experienced this before. You've never had your scales tighten up and block the elements coming in. So that's a new sensation for Val.
Okay.
But the wind does still blow through, and you feel it. Like, it's even colder outside than what it is in here, if you can imagine that. So what would you guys like to do?
Saint is still, with Ursula's help, slowly slipping her feet across the ice so that she doesn't create cracks.
We're almost there.
Thank you so much.
You got it.
So, are you going into the room?
Yeah.
Okay.
Do we get into the water?
Yes. As soon as you step into this room, you're standing in ankle-deep, ice-cold water.
Is it...
Do you have shoes on?
Yeah.
Thank you for asking. Do you have
to? Can we make it? Is the bridge then the only thing that's frozen that's left?
That everything is frozen. It's just melting. Mm-hmm. These crystals here, that's just representing the water that's flowing down into it.
Right, but is the bridge still frozen? Like
yes, not? But it is melting.
Okay.
It is narrowing down.
And the way that you're describing is this unnaturally melting or just normal melting?
It doesn't seem natural. You okay. Think if...
it's so cold in here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You think if you are where you think you are, which is the north, it would be cold enough to keep anything from melting. In fact, if you had liquids, they would start to melt. Yeah. Or they would start to freeze.
Okay.
And the big frost giants, they're melting?
Yes. The ice around them is starting to melt. Including the ice around the remoras,
like
the two dead dire reindeer, there's the cave bear, there's another frost giant, and these two frost giants you were asking about what they look like, they look like older sages or shamans.
Are their eyes open?
They're, no.
Okay.
Covered in ritualistic tattoos.
Okay, so eyes closed as if in rest.
As if they're frozen solid.
Right.
So now that Saint is in the room, is everybody else able to see?
Yes, but you're not able to see as far as Otto was, because Otto is an owl, and owl have a ridiculous amount of darkness.
I can see half as far.
I mean, your eyes take up half your head.
I mean, that's very good.
They're like this big.
Yeah. Yeah. So, really? 60?
60.
Oh, wow. Great.
I didn't get that from my parents, unfortunately. They got the big ears.
Oh, I'm sure they bring you some benefits. Well,
I can hear really good.
Oh.
do you remember what I said? You have to run faster than the avalanche?
Yeah, I think we need to
It's time to run.
I think we need to
And
move.
I'm bolting.
Yep.
Okay. So, you're going to go across the bridge first to take it?
He's faster than me, but I'm following.
Okay. As you get to...
Oh, Saint flips out. She's following, too.
Okay. As you get to the bridge, Otto, since you're first, two things happen. One, you're going to need a dex check because you're running across an ice bridge that's got water all over it. Two,
no big deal.
I need an observation roll because once you get to about halfway up onto the bridge... The ice itself starts to move, and the ceiling above you starts to move as well.
Oh, no.
With otherworldly life that you didn't see until now.
Oh, boy.
So, okay. And we're going to roll initiative as well, but give me the dex check.
Oh, okay.
Jared!
Do I have advantages?
Yes. Advantage from Richard Johnson from Texas.
Thank you, Richard Johnson from Texas.
Okay.
And you said it's just
straight dex?
Straight dex or athletics or?
It's a dex save.
It's a dex save. Okay. That is a 24.
Oh yeah, you're fine. Yeah, you sink your little auto claws into the.
And then you wanted a like perception. As
perception
well?
from you because you're the one crossing first.
Oh. You rolled a 1 and a 20.
Oh, wow. Can we have advantage, please?
You do have advantage from Labrador.
Get to keep that 20. Thank you. That's pretty rare. Oh my gosh. Okay.
This is beautiful, Ron.
This is gorgeous. I'm terrified.
It really is.
Is it all 3D printed by?
Yes.
Wow.
Yeah, I mean, some of these minis are mine, but a lot of this stuff, like the Yeti, the elementals, the flying creatures up here, the frost queen, the frost giant queen, that's all Ron.
That's stunning.
So you made your save, but your observation was what?
20, natural 20.
Oh, well then, okay. So
completely terrified.
For a moment, you're outside of the brightest part of Saint's shield. Mm-hmm. So your eyes focus. And when I say the walls move, I mean it. Part of the wall breaks away and another part of this pillar breaks away and two large ice elementals come into the room and immediately start making their way towards you, and they seem angry. Up in the ceiling, there are these, we'll call them mephits, because that's what they are. There's these little ice devils.
Oh, little flying friends.
Yeah,
got it.
That are clinging to the ceiling, and when you start to run across and the elementals wake up, they come to life as well and wake up, and they screech and chitter and start to crawl across the ceiling, and you see their wings unfurl and start to flap. We are in initiative.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh.
It's time to use the dung.
It's time.
The time has come.
Where is that dung?
So,
time has come to use the dung.
I have advantage from the Carson, and that's countered by Angel Devilson for my initiative. KoKo, you have advantage from Hadrian X.
Thank you.
Saint, you have advantage from Hadrian X.
Thank you.
Valcorio, you have advantage from Z-Man 9018.
Thank you, Z-Man.
Octavius, you have advantage from Labrador.
Thank you.
And Ursula, you have advantage from still ship Lily and Ugga. That's going way back.
And this is an initiative?
Yes.
Correct.
Okay.
So, did anyone get a 20 or above?
No.
I did. I got 23.
Okay. Did anyone beat a 19?
No.
No.
Okay.
Dang it. No, you got it.
Well.
Who got next down? So, like 19 to like 15? Anybody in there?
16.
Saint. Anyone from 15 down to 10?
12.
10.
Okay. Who are the two 12s? Who's got the higher dex?
16.
So probably Val.
Yeah.
So Val and then
Ursula. And then KoKo.
KoKo, what 10. Is your dex?
10.
It's a 16.
Your dex bonus?
16, sorry.
Yeah. Okay, so you beat the elementals, which is good.
It was 16.
Yeah, you're right. You're doing so well.
Is that everybody?
What did you get?
I had 23.
Oh, yes. I was like, wait a minute.
Yeah. Okay. So, to no one's surprise, Otto, you get to go first. Since you were going first over the bridge.
Okay.
You can, because you made your save, get all the way across the bridge if you want. I will say this. It's not that this is difficult terrain, because it's not, but if you try to do anything super acrobatic, I might have you make, at the very least, a difficult acrobatics check to do whatever it is you want to do because of the water level rising and it being even slipperier here than the Yeti room.
Okay.
Yeah.
We can still move it. It's not difficult terrain, though.
It is not difficult terrain. I'm just saying if you try to do anything crazy, like if you want to leap across the chasm, that might be an extra hard acrobatics check because you're leaping off of a wet surface.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
That makes total sense. Okay. Everything is bad and we are at a low level.
You don't want to just run right into that? I'm kidding.
I mean, So instead of running straight forward, startled by seeing these two giant beasties.
Yeah, they're huge.
They're huge. Yeah. I kind of reel back and I yell to the others, there's ice devils everywhere! And I'm going to...
Ice devils.
Yeah. It's diverse scary.
This is the worst. Man, you just came to the surface and just popped into this.
The worst day.
It really is, really is.
I'm having a not great day as well.
Very dangerous, as your uncle said. Truly, he was right.
I'm gonna give you a second.
Yes.
Because I have a cosmic yam from Syntox.
Ooh.
Two cosmic yams from Syntox. Aww,
thank you
so much. And we have balloons from Seraphie Fall and Aelvar.
Thank you.
Hopefully I'm saying that right.
So how
again
many more...
with the Aelvar.
Yeah, Aelvar.
Aelvar.
So those compound until we get another cosmic card?
Yes, you are very close to unlocking a tier 2 cosmic card.
Okay, so what's the cosmic version of Yeti dung? Soon, hopefully we find out soon.
You want more Yeti?
Well, just so you know, the cards have been good up until now, but they can be bad.
They can be not great.
And they can also be neutral where it just does stuff, but isn't necessarily good or bad.
Noodle beard.
Right.
Exactly.
Noodle beard?
That happens.
Well, it'd be a tier two noodle beard.
Well.
Wow.
You'd be surprised how delicious it is.
Tagliatelle.
Yeah. We got Alfredo sauce on there this time. It's messy.
I mean, you gotta eat.
Tier three is meatballs.
If you're lucky.
Do you know what the weight limit is for Mage Hand? Offhand? Is
five,
it 5 pounds? How much is a mephit weigh?
They're pretty light.
They're small. Although these are made of ice, so I would say they probably weigh more than 5 pounds.
Okay.
They're the same size.
Would they be pushed?
What you thinking?
Well, I would like to, I mean, listen, there are big ice things and there's few of us. If we can cause infighting between the ice things, I would want to pull a mephit down by a big metal or a big ice dude. So. Sure.
I'll tell you this, you could definitely break the hunk of ice that the mephit is holding onto, causing it to either take flight or move. You could do that with Mage Hand if you want. Although the ceilings in here are pretty tall. What's the range on Mage Hand?
The range is 30 feet. So it's,
yeah,
you can't
not gonna
do
reach.
It.
Yeah, not unless you got right up to the base of the pillar, but I don't know if you want to do that.
Okay, this is a very silly move, but I'm gonna try it. I would like to grab a chunk of snow and mage hand it so it looks like that guy threw the snowball at that guy.
Sure. Your range is 30 feet, right?
If they just start laughing, like,
so you can essentially pick up like
you're an arcane trickster, so it's an invisible mage hand, right?
It's an invisible mage hand.
Yeah.
Ooh.
So you can pick up, I'll say, a floating hunk of ice and snow that's floating here, and then you want to fling it that direction?
Yeah.
Okay, sure. I'll give you a shot.
Make them fight each other.
Mage hand.
Snowball fight.
Snowball fight.
So this would be kind of a weird roll.
Bro,
so I'm gonna say it's just
it's a weird roll.
It's gonna be an unarmed combat roll to throw or improvised weapon.
Okay.
Roll.
With dex probably, because it's thrown.
Yeah, but they are using their mage hand, so it's not, you don't get your agility because you're using your
mind.
Yes.
Right.
So I'll let you use your spell attack bonus. Whatever that
is.
Yeah.
That's
3, I believe.
Okay, yeah.
Right?
Whatever your firebolt is also your spell attack.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you can use that, sure.
Okay. Come on. That's what I want
to
do.
And you're just trying to hit the broadside of a barn, right?
True.
They're big guys.
You don't care about damage.
No.
True.
Okay. Okay.
And I want to provoke it.
Okay.
To its friend. Specifically.
Sure.
Oh, no.
Oh, you're good.
Sorry.
You're fine.
Okay. Okay.
Sorry. You have, you probably have damage.
I do?
Yes. Otto has advantage from Labradork.
Thank you!
Whoop whoop.
Whoop whoop. I'm gonna keep this one. It is a dirty 20.
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, so the little ball of like, it's funny because I used to make ice balls back home when we would, never mind.
Washington State life.
Yeah.
Having hey, some you're Washington, from Washington State.
There are
yeah.
three people at this table who are from Washington
yeah,
State.
Yeah, baby.
Represent. Anyways, you make this little slushy ball.
Yes.
And you hurl it over there and it smacks into it. And it was clearly looking at you.
Mm-hmm.
So when this snow ice ball strikes it, it's hard to read an elemental's face, but it turns towards that direction like who threw that? Like at that moment in class where it's like, who just did that?
What?
And it's just trying to discern that right now. It doesn't think that its elemental buddy did it, but it doesn't know who did it.
Good.
Yeah.
Enemies all around.
And I'm looking up their intelligence and it is not high. So
does it take a lot of damage?
It takes no damage.
No, probably not.
Emotional damage?
Yes. Yeah. It is. It's definitely confused.
Emotional damage.
Did you want to do anything else?
Bonus action to hide.
Yeah.
Okay. Are you backing off the bridge?
Backing off the bridge.
Okay. You're going to hide behind these ice chunks? Great. Advantage from Riggs 216.
Okay. That is a 18.
Rogues.
That's going to work. I mean, their passive perception is not great.
Nice.
Yeah. Even though they were all paying attention to you, you now disappear.
Goodbye.
Yeah. Great. Layer action goes off.
Oh no, Jared.
Yep. Wait, hey, what? Ron set this up. This is not me.
Sure he did.
The co-DM is in charge of combat, so he set this up.
Wait, okay. I'm sorry, what?
So yeah, layer action goes off at initiative 20. And I have four different choices that Ron created here of what could, I'm just gonna roll. What could happen on initiative 20? Number one, rumble and shake. DC 14 dex save or be knocked prone. So everybody has to do that, except for the Mephits because they can fly. But everybody has to make a DC 14 dex save or you fall prone.
Oh no, okay.
Okay.
Advantages.
Yes, please.
I have advantage from Celtic Mutt. KoKo, you have advantage from Hadrian X.
Thank you, Hadrian
Saint,
X.
You have advantage from the Cosmic Lord, but
thank
it's
you.
Countered by Failwaffle.
Thank you, Poe.
Valcorio, you have advantage from Gamer Realm.
Thank you, Gamer Realm.
Octavius, you have advantage from I Still Ship Lily and Uggo.
Thank you.
And Ursula, you have advantage from USN Rent.
Thank you.
Nice.
Is it just straight dex?
It's a dex save.
Save, okay.
Yeah.
5.
14.
So if you don't
22.
Make if you don't make 14 or above, you fall over.
Got it. Landed right at 14.
Made it.
I got 22.
Nice.
So
just the big elephant
just
girl.
Big girl falls over.
It makes sense because you already freaked out.
I was like,
if it makes you feel better, the guy that got hit by the ice.
Oh, he's having a bad day. Oh. Hey, what?
Whoa, whoa. And when I say rumble and shake, the you know, the little minor shaky shake, this is more like a earthquake, like a go go go.
Okay.
And you can see the cracks up along the walls as the water continues to drip down into the room.
Uh-oh.
Mephits.
Oh, great.
This Mephit is going to laugh gleefully as it throws a frost grenade down into this general area.
Oh.
The primal ice method blows icy air, catching it in its hand, forming an orb of ice that it can then throw at a point within 60 feet. Each creature within 5 feet of the point must make a DC 10 dexterity saving throw or take damage.
Oof.
So I'm going to say,
because
you fell, and it finds that amusing. I'm going to say that Ursula and Saint could get to make the dex save.
Okay. Oh, Ursula, I see. You fell down, so I'm going to make it worse.
Yeah. Ursula, advantage from Lesbian Wolf. And Saint, you got advantage from Hadrian X.
Thank you, Hadrian.
It's only a DC 10.
I made it. Thank God.
Made it. Also. Okay.
So you only take half damage.
Okay.
Which is 4. So 2 points of damage. And it laughs and flutters. 5, 10, far can these things fly? 30 feet. 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30.
So, how far up are they?
They're all the way up at the ceiling.
Okay.
So they're a good, like, 50 feet up.
Got it.
In fact, I'm going to put the 5 up on this dice because it's 50 feet up.
Great.
So just imagine it that
nice,
far.
Nice, nice.
And it's fluttering over to its friend, who is also going to laugh and throw a ice grenade down at the...
No
way.
Love
to laugh.
Yeah. They, by the way, I mean, you don't have to roll. You know that ice elementals and ice mephits aren't necessarily friends. Like, they're from
I think
two
we're
different.
Getting that.
Yeah.
Is that
what,
did you know that?
I sure didn't.
It was a guess.
That's pretty good.
So I have advantage from Ben22193. And I'm gonna hook my ice grenade.
Can it even take ice damage?
No, right? It's immune to ice, but I wanna see if it hits.
Sure.
So this is more about it attacking.
Great.
It does hit.
Nice.
So it pegs the ice elemental with this little frost grenade and laughs gleefully.
Two ice balls, it's
which does absolutely no damage to the ice elemental whatsoever.
But they're annoyed.
Yep. And the ice elemental is angry.
Wait,
Saint.
This guy did that to that? The mephit?
This
that?
One
yes.
threw
okay,
it down
okay.
at the one that fell over.
Okay.
Oh, so he was already down and then he
That's
hit
correct.
It again?
Yeah, because the mephits are maniacal.
They like mischief.
Yeah. Saint, what would you like to do?
So what is the bear doing behind us?
The bear's frozen in a block of ice.
Oh, I thought the giants
they
were.
They all are.
Oh, they all are.
Yeah.
And also the
Everybody.
Cat is too.
Yep.
Yeah.
Got it. So the ice elementals are the only one.
You are also frozen. Now in ankle deep water and you're laying in it.
Oh, right. That's right. I am.
Yeah. I want to get up.
Okay. So Saint had been helped along by Ursula and she just fully splats down. Very cold. Thank you. Oh, thank you. Just once again, sticks her shield into the ice and tries to get herself up.
Okay, so it's half your movement to stand up from prone. You still have half of your movement left.
This must be a test. This must be a test, right? Proving our worth. What?
Your god does not sound like a very nice person.
Well, I haven't met them yet, other than in the form of a sparrow, but,
Okay.
Okay. And she...
yes?
Turns to the frost, one of the nearest frost giant, and swings her warhammer and cracks into the ice.
Okay.
Why?
So you're going over there.
She wants to free them.
Okay.
Oh, are they nice?
I don't know.
Don't know.
Okay.
Roll an attack.
Okay.
We're gonna find out.
Risky decision.
Yes, it is.
Maybe we should have talked about this.
Welcome to Dungeons and Dragons, Harry.
There's no time to talk about it.
Maybe we should have talked about this.
Okay. That's a
Oh, sorry. You have
five.
You probably had advantage from Tim Finn.
Oh, ooh. Thank you. Because I rolled a 5. And then natural one.
Oh.
Okay. So this is what happens.
Anything?
You walk over. You're about ready to slip. You still swing anyways. And you crack into this ice, and it barely does any damage whatsoever. Like, this is a solid block of ice. And if you were, you know, if you were holding on to this thing with both hands, and you were really focusing on one point, maybe you'd be able to do a little bit of damage, but you're, like, wildly swinging this thing, and it just kind of glances off the ice.
But it still feels like even, I would have to kind of, like, whack at this to
You would have to smack this
it.
Thing for a while before it. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'm glad I still got a little bit of knowledge out of this.
Anything else?
It's not going to work. Plan B.
Good to know.
And I believe I can still use my bonus action to cast Spiritual Weapon.
Yeah.
How long does Spiritual Weapon stay up?
A minute. So it's been dropped.
The one that she had was gone.
Yeah,
so she'll cast a Spiritual Weapon.
I'm just now seeing you're wearing an elephant necklace.
I am. And when I cast it, I can make a melee spell attack against a creature within 5 feet of the weapon.
Right,
so
and what's the range on the weapon?
60 feet. Is there anybody within 60 feet of me?
10, 15,
I don't think
that
so.
One maybe.
35, 40, 45. Yeah, you can get the ice elemental. 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30. 30 feet over and 50 feet up.
That's far.
That's too far. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, on the cusp. So yeah, I'll go for the ice giant or the ice elemental that I can see.
Baby dangle.
I'm gonna do
big
that
dingle.
For your
dingle.
Sparrows for now.
Yeah.
Go ahead and roll your attack.
Okay. Well, that is 5 plus 3.
Oh, do you have advantage? Oh, no, you have to roll
attack. Damage.
Roll to hit.
Oh, roll a hit.
Yeah.
Oh.
new characters. new abilities.
Gateway guy.
Advantage?
Yeah.
Thank you, gateway guy. Okay, that's double sixes plus...
That's not gonna hit.
Plus my spell attack?
Yeah,
no?
That's not
plus
gonna
5?
Hit.
Yeah.
So
failure all around.
Your sparrows fly over, materialize, fly over to this ice elemental, peck it like crazy, and it appears to like do nothing to it. It's just solid ice. So these little sparrows are pecking away at it and not having much of an effect.
Doesn't even seem bothered.
What do you want
from me? I mean, mildly annoyed.
Okay.
Yeah, but it's hard to read the face of an ice elemental.
All right.
Yeah.
True.
Val, it's your turn.
There's a whole lot of chaos going on the other side right now between ice bombs and snowballs being thrown back and forth.
You can tell just by what's happened thus far that the Mephits and the ice elementals do not seem to be on the same team.
Right. These outcroppings here at the other end of the bridge, would they act as cover or could I hide amongst them?
Yeah.
I
mean, I definitely give you half cover.
Okay, cool. Could I try to stealth across the bridge?
Sure.
And get to the other side and kind of stay amongst those outcroppings? I want to hang there for a minute.
So, two rolls.
Mm-hmm.
One would be the dex save,
right,
which you have advantage from Jim Witted.
Thank you, Jim Witted.
The second roll is your stealth roll, which is Angel Devilson, advantage by Angel Devilson.
Thank you, Angel Devilson. dex save is an 18.
That'll do it.
And
so,
stealth.
So, you're stealthing across.
Come on.
18, 20, oh, not good. 30. It's more or less your move.
Stealth is an 11.
You think you're hidden.
I think I'm very good.
You think you just like merge right into the chunks of ice over there.
Right.
You all can see him. is that
We're
your turn?
We're not going to like...
yeah.
Okay.
That's my turn.
Ursula.
Yeah, okay. I'm going to kind of cozy up to this side of the bridge and then pull one of these Yeti dung out of my thing.
Yeah.
Am I supposed to roll to see what it does?
The survival roll is to see if you have the knowledge to use it in the way you want to use it. So if you're saying, I want to use, other than like just throwing it,
mm-hmm.
I want to use this to mask my scent,
mm-hmm.
you would roll that DC,
mm-hmm.
which you've already masked your scent by rubbing up against the Yeti. But you could also use it to...
light it on fire.
you could light it on fire and use it as a weapon. Same DC, you just have to beat that DC use it correctly.
Great. Okay, yeah. So in some sort of fling form, I want to get it over there. I probably would use a little bit more of my movement, but I want to make my check. Can I make my check first, having only gone 5 feet?
You don't think the poop will make it as far as you need to make it without getting closer.
Right. So I assess that. I'm going to go closer.
Some real, real great quotes tonight happening.
So do you want to go to the edge of the ravine or do you want to go out onto the bridge?
Well, I don't want to go out on the bridge because I'm trying not to blow his quote unquote cover.
Thank you.
Even though we...
You will be, I will let you roll from right there.
Quote,
you will essentially run to the edge, stop, and hurl it. But you will be at disadvantage because of the range.
Got it.
And the only one you can throw at is the ice elemental over there because this one's up 50 feet and that one's up 50 feet.
All right. She would know that. I'm going to go on the bridge then. I don't want to be at disadvantage.
Okay.
It's not worth it.
Give me a...
But I'm going to not make eye contact with Val at all and make it look like I don't know where...
Give me a dex save.
Bad girl, it's me.
Oh, sorry. You have advantage from love from Norway.
Oh,
that's perfect.
Thank you, Norway. The entirety of Norway?
Thank you, Norway. Okay, 21.
Yeah, you make it. Are you going to go all the way across?
Yeah, and then I'm going to also try and kind of hide among the outcropping on the other side.
Like here?
Again, yeah, but I don't see him.
Okay. I don't know if you have enough movement for that. 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30. Yeah, you have enough movement to get to where he's at.
Okay. I just won't make sure with him.
I guess you could dash, but you're trying to be stealthy,
no,
right?
No, but I'm also going to do a...
She's going to throw the thing.
I'm going to throw the thing.
So, oh, you are. Yeah. Okay. Okay, then you're not being stealthy.
You
run across
I'm
the
going,
bridge and hurl the
I'm
dump.
Naturally light on my feet as a bear.
Nice.
So...
Okay.
Bears are known for this.
Sure you are. Go ahead and roll.
A balletic bear.
All right. So I'm just doing
This is improvised weaponry, so it's going to be whatever your unarmed
attack
is. But
do I need to do the survival check first?
You're just throwing it? You're just throwing the poop.
No, I was going to do something with it, but I want to make sure, because the survival check is to make sure that I know how to use it in a beneficial way.
But right? You're just throwing it, right? You're not trying to do anything special with it? Are you trying to throw it so that it does something specific?
Yeah, I want to get right in its eyes, so
to,
it stings.
To blind it.
Yeah.
You don't have to, you don't have to make a survival check to figure out that poop in the eye stings.
Okay.
Yeah.
I don't know, it's an ice thing.
My PhD in biology tells me that if you throw this in its eye.
Yeah, poop in the eye is not a good thing.
It will not like it.
Pink
not
eye good. Is the ice.
Oh, no.
There's a lot of diseases. Right? Pee is sterile, poop is not.
Look, if you learn nothing tonight,
it's just educational programming.
Okay, so what I just rolled for then was my attack.
Yes, and I gave you advantage.
So unarmed strike, is that what you want me to do?
Yes.
Okay. You did not give me advantage.
Okay, you have advantage from RC Press.
Yay. Okay, great.
19. Nice. The reason why I'm doing unarmed strike is because it's essentially improvised weaponry.
Yeah.
You're taking something that's not normally a weapon and hurling.
Sorry, it's
so you,
my first time throwing Yeti dung.
Splatter this Yeti dung. That's one use. There's three total, so we're down to two. You splatter this ice elemental with the dung.
I've warmed it up in my hand as I was running. I want to make that. So it's going to splatter and not be frozen.
It is immune to so many different effects, but it is not immune to being blinded.
So I'm going to say,
until it removes the dung from its face, it is temporarily
blind. Yeah. It was a big piece, so it probably got in its nose a little too.
We're moving on.
Okay.
KoKo.
It's a little mouth, too.
Wait, so which one did she hit the dung with?
She smeared dung all over that.
Yeah, one on its
face.
Back and the other with dung all over its face.
KoKo yells to Otto.
Yeah!
Otto!
Yes!
What's the plan here?
I think that the little ones will help us. They fly like birds.
You think they're gonna help us?
Maybe.
Okay.
That's what I'm gonna do. I don't know.
Okay.
There's a door at the other side, too.
What? The other side?
Of the bridge.
Oh. Okay, are we trying to get out there? It's cold. It's very cold.
I think this might be a tube.
Oh! And
they gesture to all of the frozen.
By the way, rounds are about 6 seconds.
Sorry.
So no, you're fine. You can have a brief conversation, yeah. But a lot of back and forth will be your turn.
Okay, no.
Yeah.
Okay. Stop. No.
Stop.
Enough. Time out.
Is it possible? I'd like to draw my bow, do an ensnaring strike.
Ooh. Yeah, sure.
But I want to put a flaming dung on my arrow.
I think Ursula has the dung, though, unfortunately, doesn't she?
You have all the dung?
Yeah. It's in my net. But you can come get some.
That's not gonna work.
So no. Ensnaring strike. You might be onto something there.
I just don't know who I would hit.
I bet some poop dropped out of the net on the way.
How far can you walk?
It would probably take most of your turn just to get to her.
Yeah.
Because you could come up.
What else?
I can shoot from very far away,
yes,
right?
You can.
Oh, I'm just saying, if you want to come get the dung for me, I'm wondering if you can
get
to me.
Oh, yeah. I think I pass on the dung for now. For now. And that's question.
Yeah.
Are these elementals, are they impervious to, stabby things?
You don't know. If you want to roll, and this would take your action to do so, if you want to roll a knowledge check to know what they are weak to or immune to, I will give you that information.
Just take a shot.
I would take a shot.
Okay. So are you going to move or just shoot from where you're at?
I'm going to shoot from where I'm at.
Okay, and which one are you shooting? The one with dung on its face or the one laying on the ground?
The one with dung on its face because he's already stunned.
I will tell you this. When you shoot somebody that's prone, like that isometal over there, it makes it harder for you to shoot it.
Right.
So it's actually smart for you to shoot the one that's got the dung.
Yeah. That's what I was thinking.
Yeah,
you smart. Knew.
I knew you knew that.
That's why I said. It's for the audience.
Yeah. Jared is saying it for himself.
Yes.
You know the rules of D&D.
Yeah.
All KoKo, you have advantage from Hadrian X on your shot. So go ahead and take your shot.
Okay.
So.
You have advantage, right?
Another one?
Yeah. Plus your.
So
ensnaring strike is a bow attack, right?
Yep.
So that's a 15 plus.
Do I get a save?
So plus 5, right?
Oh, I thought you were.
No, you're fine.
Find something else.
No,
yeah, plus 5. 15, 20.
So dirty 20 to hit.
That hits.
Ooh,
yeah,
nice.
These don't have a great AC.
Awesome.
So.
What's that?
Armor class.
Oh.
thank you.
It took your bonus action to cast Ensnaring Strike, which is fine. The next time you hit a creature with a weapon attack, which you just did, a writhing mass of thorns appear at this point of impact, and the target must succeed on a strength saving throw or be restrained by the magical vines.
Mm-hmm.
Well, a large or larger creature has advantage. These things are large, so it does have advantage.
Okay.
If the target succeeds on the save, the vines shrivel away. While restrained by the spell, they take extra damage. So I'm going to make my
roll.
Does blind give it? No, not for strength.
No, not for strength.
Okay.
I also have advantage from... Actually, I'm not going to use the advantage because it's already got advantage for being large.
Right.
I rolled bad.
Wow.
Strength?
Yeah.
15? That's enough?
It's got to be.
It's still enough.
It's got to be.
Okay.
Your spell save is...
I think it's 15.
Yeah. It's probably lower.
Mine's 13. Yeah.
So... Really? It's only 13? Wow. So the vines wrap up.
13 is
yeah. Okay, so it's it. The vines wrap up around it. Roll your damage. You still did your damage.
That's right. You still hit it. So D8.
Oh, D8.
Yes,
three.
Wait, what?
So D8. And okay. Three.
Yeah. The vines wrap up around the elemental, and you can see it start to struggle with it, and then it just rips one shoulder free and rips another shoulder free, and continues to try to get the dung off of its face.
Four.
That's it.
Something.
Plus your, don't you get your fey thing as well?
Oh, yeah. Because of weapon strike. Yeah. So another roll of d4.
Okay.
So you did 4 damage?
4 plus another little pyramids.
All right. I wish these were weighted. Anybody else?
You can get metal ones.
I know.
4.
Okay.
Eight.
So 8.
Nice.
Yeah.
Nice. The fey is strong.
And you can tell the damage from the bow went through. It is not immune to piercing.
Okay.
And it's not resistant to piercing either. So you did damage. But the vines did not do much. Yeah. Great. So that's your turn. Or did you want to move?
Well, when I hit them with the ensnaring strike, did it do the psychic damage at all? Like, are they like, is it that like stunned thing for a minute?
No,
because
it resisted it.
Yeah.
I gotcha. Okay.
The vines wrapped around it, and then it broke free of the vines because it's just so large and so strong. Okay.
So it took the damage and it took the hit, but the vines it basically smashed.
That's my turn, right?
Well, you still have your movement if you want to move anywhere. You use your action and your bonus action, but you still have your movement.
Yeah.
How far can I move?
35.
Yeah, 35 because you're a wood elf.
Yep.
I mean, I'd like to get to the other side of that, the thing, but I don't think I can make it.
Bridge?
Plus they're in, 10, on the, 15, in the 20, way.
25, 30. Yeah, you would be pretty piled up. It would be like Val hunched over.
It doesn't seem very
wide. Ursula hunched over Val. And then you hunched
over. They can't
over.
See us, right?
The three of us in a line. Is there any other way across it?
You can run and try to jump the ravine.
But you're jumping out of like ankle deep water.
I'm gonna do it.
Oh, yeah!
Okay.
This side or that side?
Let's go to the right.
High five on the
way. You're at disadvantage because you're jumping off of a watery, slippery surface, but you're at advantage from Hadrian X.
Thank you.
So you're at a flat roll for your acrobatics.
All right.
Acrobatics check.
Okay. One roll.
So just roll 1d20.
Yeah. And you really
do not want to fail this roll.
Come on, don't fail this.
There you go.
Oh no, what was it? What did you roll?
She leaps across, lands on the edge, thinks she made it, makes it, and then she does that. And she falls backwards into the water.
Oh, okay.
No.
Guys, I rolled a three.
Three for a six. Yeah.
Oh no.
It's DC 10. The water is not as deep as you were expecting it to be. You actually feel the surface below you, but as you are like putting your arm and your leg down, the surface that the water is resting on starts to crack and break through. And you can actually see the water draining into a deeper crevasse, a deeper level.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, I guess.
We're going to take the elemental's turn. This elemental is going to take its action to smear the poop away from its face so it can see. Is that its whole turn, really?
Yep, bye.
Yeah,
this method was the one that threw... that method threw through. Yes, yeah.
So this elemental is going to take half of its movement to get up. So it's got 15 feet left.
Uh-huh.
Which is not enough for it to... No, it can get to you.
Okay.
5, 10, 15. Okay.
Hello.
So...
Hi.
Although...
Those methods were real mean to you, buddy.
Although, it was angered by whatever threw the thing at it, so it's trying to figure out what that thing is, and you have not attacked it yet, correct?
Nope, I have not.
And you have not attacked it yet, correct?
No, I just attacked its friend, but it doesn't know that.
Right, it doesn't matter because it's laying on its back.
Right.
Okay. So it moves to there, and it is going to do...
I'm hiding so well right now.
It is going to do an area effect where it literally reaches up, grabs onto its shoulders, pulls off pieces of ice in its hand, lifts it above its head, and crushes it.
Oh.
The ice shatters and flies out in 10 feet in all directions.
Wow. Nice.
You and you get to make... DC 15 dexterity saving throws.
Okay.
Goodness gracious.
Really Ursula, you have advantage from Labrador.
Thank
and
you.
And Val, you have advantage from Branded Nerd.
Thank you, Branded Nerd. You
what
said
is
dex?
It? Dex?
Dex.
Nat 20.
Ew, I got 13.
You failed. On a failure, the target takes 2d8.
You suck.
2d8?
8. Plus 4 is 12 points of cold damage.
Good lord.
Ouch.
And if the target is large or smaller, you fall prone.
Oh, no.
Oh, hey.
And grapple, blah, 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 but it doesn't even know you're there. Yeah, that's it. So,
do I take any damage?
No, you made your save.
Made the save.
It's not even like half damage if you...
Oh, perfect.
Yeah. So you don't even have to worry about your cold resistance.
Okay.
It was cold damage, though.
Nice.
So, for future reference.
Nice, okay.
And it roars as it realizes that whatever it was that threw that thing at it is not there, or it's not in its purview.
Right.
In fact, it's going to look around. So, give me another stealth check.
Okay.
And you just fell over, right?
Yeah.
So, you get a stealth check as well to see if it's going to notice you. It might notice the method. As well.
Okay, cool.
So Ursula, advantage from Labradork, and Val, advantage from Ow My Knees.
Ow My Knees!
And Ben 22193 gave me advantage for my perception.
Just a stealth check, you said, yes?
Yes.
I got a nat 20.
21.
Oh!
Okay. It sees the method.
Nice.
And so it rages, shatters this ice, does damage to everything around it, and then looks up and sees this method. And shakes its fist at it, and that's gonna be the end of our show.
Oh my gosh!
So we're gonna pause there.
Ah!
But, as some of you that are watching know, we do something special at the end of every show. I know, it's a lot. We're taking in a lot tonight. new characters, new people. It's fun. It's been a fun night.
So much.
You're
doing great.
Right into it.
So at the end of every show, we do something that's a little fun, a little silly. I'm gonna look up the suggestions.
Yeah.
Where we read out the team force of nature and team force of cosmos, our highest tier patrons get their names read off in a silly, fun way. And you two can jump in on this as
okay,
well.
Okay, sure.
Let me find the suggestions. You guys have your sheets?
I do.
We do. Okay, cosmos and nature. Wow. new.
Do we want to do nature first, or we want to do cosmos first?
Let's do nature first.
Okay.
We have that side. Do nature or no?
What?
Well, anybody can do these. Actually.
Oh, okay, got it.
So, for Team Force of Nature, this was suggested by Corey Phillips. You're all at a press junket for MCU Phase 47, so the Marvel's Universe, Phase 47, where they're announcing all the remaining Marvel heroes getting shows / movies in the coming year, which Jessica, of course, spoiled to everyone.
Oh, so it's based on true events.
Yes. So take it away whenever you're ready. This is our press junket.
Jessica Lynn Parsons, hi. I'm Morgan Peter Brown from Entertainment Weekly. Can you talk about your role as the Gold family in the new film Braba, Force of Just Jewels?
Yeah, so the Gold family is a really interesting character because I play every single family member. That's
incredible.
My superpower.
Is that your publicist?
That's Lesbian Wolf, so let's just...
Oh, okay, yeah, this...
Sure,
there's
okay.
There's a beaker par in my contract that says I can't say much more on this.
Oh, Fenderella, okay.
Mm-hmm. We have a sidekick whose name is...
Kitty Scritches.
I don't know what I can say.
Yes.
That's in the preview. That's in the...
Yes.
Are the rumors true that Armando 89 is going to be playing your love interest for three of your characters?
Spicy.
Yeah, so we're actually old friends, and this is fine to say?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, yes. And look, I just want to make it clear that my past decisions with him, just as your past decisions, don't have any bearing on our relationship in the film.
Irrelevant?
Last question. Will the supervillain Mickey Wolf destroying every member of the Gold family in this film?
Yeah, it's crazy what happens at the end of the movie.
Right at the end?
Okay, yeah. Actually, that's all the time we have for today. Thank you so much.
Okay.
Thank you so much for coming.
Okay, it's coffee.
Yay. Coffee.
That was good. It's interesting doing these face to face.
It's so weird.
We've never done it.
This is so weird.
We're always doing these like in
the.
I
know.
Yeah. Okay, cool.
Okay.
So that was Team Force of Nature.
Team Force of Cosmos.
Team Force of Cosmos. This is by Thomas Calton.
Sure.
This is a Dungeon Run emergency staff meeting. You're all brainstorming ways to end the episode after someone accidentally deleted all the patron suggestions.
Oh my gosh.
Oh wow.
Look.
So, you know, pretty much like our usual.
Guys, I was staying up really late, I'm sorry. I just, delete is right next to save, isn't it?
It's pretty close. You have to click it and then there's a drop-down menu, but yeah, you deleted the suggestions.
I did.
And the patron names.
I Gorbin-plated the whole thing.
Oh. Okay, this is a real student of groom situation.
Yes. Give him a Lincoln break, all right? He was up late.
Thank you. I am, but I think I'm nuts.
Well, that's wild, man.
I appreciate the sympathy.
Look, we're all down to clown. Yeah. We can do this together, okay?
Okay.
We'll just ask them for...
Just for their names again?
Yes!
That's such a good idea!
Absolutely.
Why didn't you think
I'm
of
so
that?
Glad you're here, Kari. Thank
all
you so much.
All we need to do is log into
Wait
patron.
A minute.
Yeah.
Kari doesn't come to the meeting.
No, she does now because she just saved the whole thing.
She saved the show.
I did it!
You're
okay,
going to spend
so
the next
nice.
Week in a freezing river.
I don't know.
Yeah. So tune in next week.
And check out patreon.com/thedungeonrun. You too can become a High Member patron and have your name read off in this insanely silly manner.
Thanks, Katie, for that. You know what I'm saying, right? What is it called?
Right?
That's been our first episode.
Oh my gosh.
First episode in the studio.
Super exciting.
Thank you.
Extra special thanks to Sean up in the booth.
Yes.
Woo! Good one.
Chris Perry.
Yeah, is running music.
Yes, to Joseph, who's running sound tonight as well, to Adam and all of 2 Kings Entertainment here with the stage. This, we're so excited, this is so great. We get to come right back here next week.
Yeah. And Ron Ogden.
Ron, we love you! I wish you were here! But I think that's it. Yeah.
And as we always say at the end of every show, humankind.
Be both!
Good night!
Bye.
It started as a simple dungeon run. As a simple dungeon run.